Cowboys Stadium in Arlington, Texas is all decked out. One piece of the BCS puzzle remains. Texas quarterback Colt McCoy attempts to lead the Longhorns into the national championship game against Alabama. But standing in his way, Nebraska defensive sensation Ndamukong Suh. The Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship is coming up next. It is always the hope. For this team, this year, it was always the plan. With a quarterback whose name, Colt McCoy, sounds like he was born to lead the Longhorns. They set the bar high, and now they're poised to leap over into the BCS title game and on to a fifth national championship. From day one, they felt that was their fate. But there is Nebraska to deal with first. A program with a pure grade pedigree and every bit as much pride as the undefeated team they face. The Cornhuskers have been to the top before. Tonight, the role of spoiler and the conference title will suit them just fine. It's all on the line in prime time. Texas, Nebraska, for the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship. Texas, where Nebraska is looking to mess with Texas in a championship matchup that has its history of upsets in the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship on ABC. For the Longhorns, folks, the stakes are sky high. No margin for error tonight. While the Husker Nation attempts to throw the college football world into a frenzy with an upset. And we've already had one upset today, and that, of course, in the SEC championship game, number two knocking off number one, 32-13. So now Bama will move to the BCS championship game, and we will solve the rest of the puzzle, but maybe we won't, because if Nebraska stages an upset for the ages, folks, all bets are off. It'll go to the computers, trust me. But, Herbie, what about the way Alabama played today?
What an amazing effort, group effort. It starts with Nick Saban, both his coordinators. They just not only outplayed Florida, but they dominated the game. They outcoached Florida, and they were the hungrier team. So now, as you said, it comes down to this, the final piece. If Texas wins, they advance, and if they lose, let the games begin.
And one of the great offensive players of the year, Colt McCoy, leads Texas here tonight.
We've seen Colt McCoy doing it in Austin now for 4 years, and this is an opportunity for, I think, him to really step out and really make a statement. We've seen him with the accuracy, and right now I think he's playing as well as he's played all year. A huge game last week against Texas A&M with his mobility and, of course, the intangibles that he brings to the table.
Let's go! Hey, our town tonight! This is our house! From the very beginning, let's go!
Brett, that's the area that I think really he's begun to settle down, not worry about the pressure of getting to this moment. Now he's just playing in the last four or five games. So in my opinion, he comes into this game playing his best football of the year.
There is a roadblock. Where's number 93? Ndamukong Suh of Nebraska. What a year he's had.
Ndamukong Suh is the most dominant defensive lineman in all of college football. And of course he has the great size. But I think the one thing that stands out is the combination of the speed and the quickness and the power to go along with that. The coaches say his awareness is probably as good as they've seen, almost like a linebacker, has great instincts, but there's the quickness. You can see how quickly he gets off and has a chance to make a play in the open field. So Sue's going to have to be able to step up. For Nebraska to compete tonight, their defense has to get their offense the ball in a short field.
And as Kenny Chesney will tell you, tonight for Nebraska or Texas, this will be their moment.
This is our destiny. Big 12 championship game. Bo Pelini, his Nebraska counterpart, though, comes here for the first time to see if he can lead the Cornhuskers to a title. Mad Dog Matson leads the horns out. Has been the Nissan pregame show. Kickoff for Texas and Nebraska. Coming up next. Well, the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship is the last stop along the drive to the national championship. They'll be playing for the Coach's Trophy presented by Dr. Pepper out of Pasadena, and already you see the Crimson Tide has qualified to be one of the teams. And let's go down to referee Tom Walker.
Guys,
now for the coin toss.
We have a special guest tonight flipping the coin for us. Tim Millis, longtime NFL official, former coordinator of officials for the Big 12 Conference, and next week being inducted to the National College Foundation Hall of Fame as an official, will be flipping the coin for us tonight. Thank you, Tim. Texas, you're the visitor. What's your call?
Tails.
Tom, Tails is called. Tim, Tails. Heads, Nebraska, you win. What's your choice? You want to defer? Nebraska wins. Defers, second half. Get the ball. Where do you want to defend? Want to kick that way? Come over here. Texas, over here.
Let's go down to Coach Mack Brown with Lisa Salters and find out about the horns on offense to begin the game.
Thank you very much, Brent. Well, Mack, everybody in the building, including your players, knows that Alabama is waiting for you in Pasadena. How do you make sure that your players don't overlook that team on the other sideline that's waiting for them tonight?
Our goal from this time last year was to get here and win the Big 12 championship, and it has not changed. And we understand we're guaranteed nothing after tonight unless we win.
I know that Colt McCoy does not like to talk about personal accolades, but I know that you would like to see him win the Heisman. What personal advice did you give him before coming out here tonight?
Great players step up on the big stage, and when you've won 44 games, you just need to be yourself.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa, and of course, Bo Pelini, defensive specialist on the other side. Coached with linebackers and secondaries in the National Football League. Played safety himself at Ohio State. And was the defensive coordinator when LSU won the national championship. And because Florida lost earlier today, the nation's longest winning streak belongs to Texas at 16. TCU, one of those teams, pulling for BCRS chaos. In other words, it's spelled N-E-B-R-S-K. Nebraska, that's the team they're rooting for. If you're a Cincinnati or a TCU fan and you want to get to Pasadena, you want Ndamukong Suh and the Cornhuskers to come through. The young man who will kick it off is from right here, nearby Fort Worth. Ade Kanalik has the ball on the tee, and Marquise Goodwin and Malcolm Williams will be back deep for the horns. The stadium that has set a new standard for stadiums in this country, and we are underway. And it'll come out on the 20-yard line. And so, Herbie, here comes Colt McCoy, and I was impressed, as I think you were, with the emergence of Trey Newton as the running back for the Horns the other night.
Yeah, he did a lot in that game against Texas A&M, but it all, of course, starts with Colt McCoy. His ability, I think, to make quick decisions. Brandon, talking to him this week, he has more confidence right now in his group of wide receivers and the way they've grown up around Jordan Shipley that I think it's allowed him to just settle down and go out and just play football and have a lot of fun doing it and having a lot of confidence along the way.
Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator, will check out the secondary's coverage here, the opening series. They're going to throw right up. Kirkendall dropped it. That's incomplete. The line judge with the call. Amu Kamara, number 21, was the corner coming up quickly on number 11.
Personal foul. Shot block. Offense number 71. At the distance to the goal. Repeat first down.
A very good center guilty. Chris Hall, and he's from also nearby Irving, Texas, a senior, and he's made a lot of all Big 12 teams.
It's interesting that you have your guard and Huey locked up there with Ndamukong Suh, the best defensive tackle in college football. And early, Texas trying to send a message to Suh where they're trying to take him out. That time they got caught for it.
That shuttle pass on the inside to Newton. Newton breaks free. A first down at the 36-yard line. Stealing a page from Tim Tebow for 25 yards.
Here's Ndamukong Suh right here. And one way to slow down an aggressive defense early, a little bit of a screen or a draw. They get the ball to Newton in the open field. The defensive line gets upfield in a hurry. Great way to slow down the Nebraska front four.
Keeping it deflected, could be intercepted. It is picked off at the 40-yard line. The deflection sent it up in the air, and Nebraska with the first turnover of the game as Eric Haig comes down with it, a junior corner from Arizona.
And give Pierre Allen, the defensive end, a lot of credit. This Nebraska defensive line, this is exactly what they have to do. If you can't get penetration and get to Colt McCoy, knock the ball down. And that time, Allen did that, and a very, very good job of being aware by Haig to come up with a crucial interception for Nebraska.
Zach Lee under center for the Huskers. And he hands off to Roy Helu, his junior running back from Danville, California. This is the kind of game we expect to see. As far as Nebraska is concerned, they'll try to shorten the game. Herbie, obviously, they're going to run the ball. They're going to try to keep that clock moving. First downs are very important. This is not an explosive offensive team.
This is so far textbook for Nebraska. Get a turnover, get a short field to work with for their offense. It's a power offense, a little bit one-dimensional, but they do have the ability to throw play-action pass downfield.
Rex Burkhead. Draw with Burkhead, the backup high back, short of that first down.
For Bo Pelini and Nebraska Cornhuskers, this is exactly what the blueprint to this football game is. They realize they've got to win in the small areas, win the turnover margin, special teams, field position has to give them an advantage. They've got to work with a short field, and when they get the short field, they have to take advantage of it.
Luggate is the fullback, and Burkhead stays in on third and short. He'll follow the fullback, has to battle back, and the Horn defense, very stout in the middle, would not let him sniff the first down. Lamar Houston and Sam Acho coming up with the stop. So it's number 81 of the Acho brothers. The other one reversed the number. That's Emmanuel. He's number 18.
Big call here early for Bo Pelini in Nebraska.
Look who came in.
Absolutely.
Ndamukong Suh to lead this on fourth down and one. Here we go. Burkhead stays in. Behind Ndamukong. Cut back. It's going to be very close. It's going to depend on the spot. I don't think he got it if that spot that I'm looking at is where they're going to put the football. With a second effort, he spun free, but they may have already had it down. Houston down there in the bottom of it. Very close on fourth down and one. Remember the yellow line that you have the pleasure of watching. That's an unofficial mark. Generally, it's right on the money, we should add. But in this instance, we'll just let them come and measure.
Tremendous effort by Texas's defensive front there on those last three plays.
Texas football. Herbie, what did you think of his strategy here to run
power three consecutive times.
Three straight times. It's their identity. It's who they are. But the problem is they have not faced a defensive front as talented as Texas all year long. You have to go throughout this game and break some tendencies if you want to have a chance of being successful moving the football. Looks like they're going to check this spot through replay to see if he maybe got shortchanged a bit on the spot.
It all depends on where they whistled it down. I saw the back spin off, and he would have made it, but it may have been whistled dead. So the replay people upstairs, right, off to our left up here, are now taking a look at it, the Big 12 officials, and that's our referee, Tom Walker. Interestingly enough,
I think, Brent, one of the things that they might be taking a look at is on that third and fourth effort, it looked like he landed on a Nebraska defender, but he didn't touch the surface himself, and he kept fighting for extra yards, and it looked like he eventually extended the ball across the first down line. And maybe that's what they're looking. They have to take a closer look at that.
I'm only chuckling because Bo Pelini doesn't have to look very far in this stadium to find a replay board. Right above him is the largest television screen in the world. And it just shows you what kind of a television set you can buy for $40 million. Unbelievable.
After further review, the ball will be placed on the 31-yard line and remeasure.
Here we come.
Yeah, this is going to be interesting.
And also, when we heard that one replay, I did not really hear a distinctive whistle in there. So it's going to be very, very critical on the remeasurement. And Max said, what, are you kidding me? Well, this, I should point out about the replay officials here, kind of interesting. This is the first time that they've worked with high-definition equipment up there. And I said, you guys are going to love that. And they said, you got that right. So we have,
based on that spot, Brent, that's a first down.
And now it's time for the other side to cheer.
Brent, I think it's worth repeating that he landed on a defender, but he never touched the ground. And that's why they went upstairs to take a look. How about an appreciation for the effort by Burkhead? See right there, he is still up. The play is still alive. And they had initially spotted him, thinking that he was down when he landed on the defender right there. But he kept working to get the first down. That's a good call.
So Lee and Roy Heller will be his eye back here on first down. They have found out how stout the line is. Incomplete on his first pass. He was aiming for Ben Cotton, a tight end. And let us check in tonight for the first time with Matt Weiner. Matt.
Thank you, Brad. I'll make you a deal. You watch the Horns and Huskers. I'll keep an eye on the ACC Championship, starting with this Taco Bell update. Clemson's C.J. Spiller is a bit of an underdog Heisman candidate, but he's off to a great start. A 40-yard run here. Two plays later, Spiller would knock it in, and Clemson has the jump on Georgia Tech in their very first ACC title game.
And here it is, second and 10 for the Huskers. Hello, behind the left side, the veteran side of the Cornhuskers line. Now, Herbie, let's take a look at the Dr. Pepper impact players.
Well, they have a great combination in the backfield. It's led by Roy Helu, number 10. You're going to see him tonight probably get the ball 25 times. Now, interesting, we put Alex Henry as a punter up there. Six punts last week against Colorado, averaged 51 yards, four of them inside the Colorado 20. He needs a huge night. And, of course, Ndamukong Suh has got to be able to do what they did the first time out, and that is create turnovers to give their offense that's somewhat limited a short field to work with, which is exactly what they've done here in this first possession.
Third and seven for Zachary. Going to throw it. Got one-on-one down the near side, end zone, and waved off. They say that the receiver, Brandon Kinney, the sophomore from Kansas City, out of bounds.
This ball is thrown to the outside shoulders. Pretty good coverage. Kinney gets off the line pretty quickly, but the ball is thrown out of bounds, and Kinney really, because of the coverage, has no room at all to work there.
You talked about Henry the punter. Now let's talk about him as a field goal specialist. He has hit four of his last five. 46 is his long for this season. but he hit a 57-yarder in Lincoln against Colorado. This for 45 yards on the money. Is it long enough? And he has put him ahead. Alex Henry, who will punt and kick field goals and extra points here tonight, puts him up by three. Now watch this hole, Herbie.
Wow. Get the ball down. Henry didn't lose his focus.
Oh, doesn't the Pittsburgh youngster wish that he had stayed with it and got it down? What a tough way to lose. We've got a timeout. Well, 96 right there in the back deserves a lot of credit for the hold he put down, Herbie. It's Brett Maher. He's a redshirt freshman, a walk-on from Kearney, Nebraska. And he did the job, got it down for Henry.
Give him an assist, and along with Pierre Allen, who created the interception by Hag with that deflection.
Kanalik has a deep foot into the end zone. That's twice he's gone deep here. And Herbie, here are the Dr. Pepper impact players for Texas.
Yeah, we've talked about the receivers. We know about Jordan Shipley. Comes in tonight with 99 receptions on the year. Remarkable. But the growth of these two, starting with Malcolm Williams, number 9. You'll see him get some one-on-one opportunities to the split side all by himself. He's got to make plays. And James Kuykendall, these last 3 or 4 games, has really emerged. And I think it's taking a lot of the pressure off of Jordan Shipley, who is lined up predominantly in the slot.
I could just feel fans from Cincinnati and those at TCU saying, keep it going, keep it going. Colt McCoy steps off to the right. Underneath throw to Trey Newton, the redshirt freshman that played at a great high school here in Texas, South Lake. Gomes is the defensive back out of Hayward, California for the Cornhuskers.
This Nebraska defense has a mindset very similar to what Oklahoma challenged Texas with their, it's called a matchup zone, which means they're going to take away all the underneath easy throws that Colt McCoy likes to throw to Jordan Shipley and that group of receivers.
Second and 6, and they come back with power and Newton, stopped by Jared Crick. Ndamukong Suh, Herbie, gets all the notoriety, but do not overlook number 94. Crick is an outstanding running back.
And they feel that in the future, Crick will become the next Suh. But Suh creates a lot of double teams, and it's freed up Jared Crick for some one-on-one opportunities, and it allowed him to become an all-conference performer this year.
Fozzie Whitaker, the running back next to McCoy. On this 3rd and 5, Colt incomplete. This time, it's 3 and out for the black shirts. Positive start for Nebraska.
This is what Bo Pelini wants to do. Get creative. There he comes on a corner blitz. Amu Kamara, the defensive back, corner blitz, getting creative, mixing up the looks, trying to get the offensive line and Colt McCoy out of sync and out of rhythm. So far, the first two series successful.
Miles Paul, excellent return man, back for Nebraska, standing on his own 35-yard line. There he is right there, number 24. Got a little giddy up. Tucker low, going to take a bounce for the Horns. Scooped up now. And Paul will make it no further than the 36-yard line. Nebraska 3, Texas nothing. The Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship. Well, we're back, and the fans certainly enjoying the game and this setting. 2-year contract. We played here in Arlington next year. 1st down and 10. Option look by Lee coming down the line, and he keeps it for a yard. Heller was the pitch back, and he got it a little too far to that sideline. You're an expert in the option here, my friend.
Well, one thing that any quarterback could tell you is when you run an option on 1st and 10 and you have 9 white jerseys in that box area, it's tough for anybody to execute. And that's what Zach Lee, Brent, is going to be facing on 1st and 10. And that's why Texas right now doesn't fear Zach Lee in the passing game. They're going to load up to stop the running game. And then when they get him to 3rd down, that's when they're going to put a lot of pressure on Zach Lee.
Sam Acho, number 81, the junior for the Horns, made a fine defensive play there. 2nd down and 9, and Lee now going to come deep down the far side. Intercepted by Gideon. Blake Gideon hauls it in, so it's a pick apiece.
This is what Nebraska has tried to avoid during their their five-game winning streak since the eight-turnover game against Iowa State. Right in the back of the middle of your screen, Gideon playing center field reads the eyes of the quarterback, and Zach Lee's biggest mistake is he threw the ball with too much air, giving Gideon enough time to come over and make the play, and he threw it to the inside instead of the outside of the wide receiver. That is Texas's 22nd interception this year. They had six all of last year.
And for Gideon, Herbie, that's his fifth. First down and 10, and McCoy's going to put it back up on first down. Couldn't find a receiver. Sue closing in from the backside. There is the champ. Sue and his buddy Crick.
This is exactly what Nebraska wants to do. The matchup zone. Take away the underneath throws, the easy throws to Colt McCoy. How many times have we seen him want to get rid of the ball quickly? But when they're covered, you have to hold on to the football, and that allows Nebraska's talented front four to get pressure. They want to pressure with four and allow the back seven to be in pass coverage. Again, perfection by Nebraska.
David Snow in the offensive line could not hold up against Sue, so they came in underneath to Danny Buck. And that'll bring up third down. Amu Kamara making the stop defensively, so he's been in on a couple of early plays defensively. This is going to be third and long. This is not what the Horns and Greg Davis wanted here tonight against this defense.
And Greg Davis told us this week the best way to attack a defense that wants to match up with your underneath throws is eventually you have to do two things. Run the ball and beat them downfield with a long pass downfield. There's Greg Davis up top to your left.
Five defensive backs. McCoy waits near side, intercepted, picked off. That is the second interception. Amu Kamara. And now you talked about the Horns. Well, the Cornhuskers with these two, they now have 18 interceptions on the season.
Shipley is his primary receiver. Watch Shipley off the ball. Colt McCoy on third down. To get the football to him, but even if he did, he's covered. Look at the coverage and the recognition right now by Nebraska's defense. It's almost as if they're in the huddle with Texas and they know what's coming every time Colt McCoy goes back to throw.
That was really close on that sideline, and that's going to be stopped. They're going to take another look at this. When we saw it live, I thought it was very close. The crowd here, the Texas crowd on this side, they were shouting incomplete.
Play is under further review.
So let's see if a foot came down.
Allen actually getting the pressure there again.
A great work by his left toe is down.
Yeah.
Great work.
Great call on the field.
Yes, it was. The official right there. Watch number 21's left foot right there. Yep. Toe down. That's a brilliant piece of work. He, like so many of the youngsters from out of state, Amu Kamara from Glendale, Arizona, playing in that secondary.
Further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Interception. First down.
And that's his fifth.
Brett, we can't say it enough. Nebraska's defensive game plan is to take away the easy throws from Colt McCoy, which is an extension, really, of their running game. Those quick throws that McCoy wants to be able to utilize, they're taking those away, making him hold the ball. He has nowhere to go with the football in these first few series.
Zach Lee and the Huskers, they will start in Longhorn territory. Up by a field goal, if you just joined us. Hello, the running back, fine second effort. And he got halfway to that first down, busting across the 40-yard line.
That's what it's going to take, his second and third effort. And Rex Burkhead, the true freshman, when he's been in there, and, of course, the junior, Roy Helu. I mean, you're going to run into a wall. You got to keep moving your feet and try to get your offense into. This is one of those offenses that needs to be in second and six and third and second. They can't afford to deal with long down and distances.
Chucky Brown is playing the right defensive corner instead of Curtis Brown right now on second down. Hello. And again, a second effort. This will be third and short. And this is the sort of distance, Herbie, that the Cornhuskers won on their third downs here tonight.
Yeah, they've got to stay on schedule. Saying earlier that this is an offense that just has to just eventually move the ball down the field. It's not going to be flashy. The only time you'll see them flashy is on first and 10 when they mix in a little bit of play action just to keep Texas's defense honest by getting it downfield. But let's see again. Let's see who wins this battle in the short yardage.
Heller is the eye back. Luggate is the lead fullback. Need a yard. The middle of that Texas defensive line has been stout here early. They're going to throw on it. Third down, in trouble. Has to throw it away, and here is fourth down, and a decision to be made by Pelini and the Cornhuskers.
Well, he had the tight end right away. McNeil, the H-back, actually slips out. Actually, it's Drew Young slips out. Earl Thomas comes over, but if the pressure would not have been able to submerge Zach Lee, I think he would have been able to pick up the first down there. But a good job by Texas of penetrating the offensive line.
And that was Keaston Randall, Herbie, number 91, the sophomore from Beaumont, Texas, who was bringing the heat. And here it is, a 52-yard attempt. Remember I told you, he's hit a 57-yarder. He whacks it. Looks like he's got it. Brilliant. Two field goals for Alex Henry, the junior from Omaha. And the black shirts, a two-touchdown underdog, lead it by six. MetLife is providing these dramatic views of Cowboys Stadium of the Dallas, Texas area. MetLife provides coverage of major sporting events while also providing you with guarantees for the ifs in your life. Folks, you're never without a television monitor in this beautiful stadium. There are 3,000 flat screens. Two huge screens along the side, then look at the size that you get to check from the end zone seats. And because of those, you never have a bad seat in Cowboys Stadium. It is a thing of beauty. This one to the goal line now, and here comes Goodwin. He's got breakout speed, but they nail him at the 21. Good special teams coverage. Well, the Bowl Selection Special powered by Chevy Silverado on ESPN tomorrow night at 8. Join Reese Davis and the gang. They'll dissect and analyze the matchups of all 34 bowl games. Here tonight, we are concentrating on the last one, the BCS Championship game. Congratulations to Nick Saban and Alabama. They win the SEC. They'll be there. If Texas wins this, they'll be there. If Nebraska upsets Texas, stay tuned, folks. Stay tuned. It'll be close between TCU and Cincinnati. First down and 10, and a penalty flag is thrown. That's a false start. This is coming back.
Dead ball. False start. Offense, number 11, 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
That is Kirkendall. He's been coming on the last couple of weeks, too, Herbie.
Absolutely.
You know, he's had 3 touchdowns in the Horns' last couple of games, but here tonight he has dropped one and now a false start. No excuse for a wide receiver to have a false start. You know that. First down and 15. Running hard to the right, has to throw it away, and he was being flushed from that pocket as Barry Turner and Sue were coming across.
Yeah, right now, I'm evaluating and watching Texas in these first few series. Quite simply, they're just getting whipped up front in the battle in the trenches. Nebraska doing a great job of winning that battle. But Nebraska's playing with one linebacker. If Texas wants to get some rhythm going, they're going to have to do one of two things. Run the football into the one linebacker look with 6 defensive backs, or you've got to get vertical by throwing the football downfield to either Marquise Goodwin, James Kirkendall, or Malcolm Williams.
The Horns wanted the football changed, and that's why we had the stoppage. Second and 15, they go empty, they spread the field. Here comes pressure on the blitz, and nothing doing as Sue will stand up the receiver who didn't have a chance, and that was Young Goodwin. And because of Gomes pressuring, there was no chance.
Well, right now they're confused up front. The Nebraska defense is doing such a great job of disguising the looks, and because that time they had seven defensive backs in the game, four down linemen and seven defensive backs, and I think because they have so many different looks and personnel, it's really affecting the continuity and the communication of the pass protection of Texas's offensive line.
Third and 17 for McCoy. They'll come underneath, juggled and dropped. Incomplete. Williams couldn't hold on that time.
Tell you, this reminds me of the Texas-Oklahoma game the last time we were in the city of Dallas, when Oklahoma's defense had their way with Texas's offense early in that game by mixing up the looks and confusing Colt McCoy in the offensive line, and they really didn't find any rhythm until the second half.
Tucker will punt it, and there stands Niles Paul. He's had one punt return for a touchdown this year. He'll field this one. Remember the last one he had to pick up on a couple of bounces. He's standing on the Cornhuskers 46-yard line. Rocket ship. High bounce out of bounds. And it looks like it's going to be marked at about the 38-yard line. And that's where they will put it in play. Herbie, what about the battle of field position here tonight?
The early part of this football game, Bo Pelini telling us all week that their defense had to create the short field to give their offense a chance to have confidence and to get themselves to believe. Well, right now, Nebraska's starting right around midfield with their first few possessions. They've been able to come up with a couple big turnovers to get the ball and go down and come up with 6 points. But if this were to continue, this is exactly what Nebraska wants.
Let me correct myself. That ball is out at the 34-yard line. That's where they marked it. It'll be first and 10 for Zach Lee and the Huskers. Burkhead back in as the eye back. Play fake. They're going to throw on first under pressure and underneath, but they still pick up about 3 yards.
Again, it's not a huge gain, but it's just showing Will Muschamp in Texas that they're not afraid on first and 10 to break the tendencies and to throw the football. Not a big gain, but it's effective, not only because you pick up some yards, but you send a message to Will Muschamp, again, the linebackers and the safeties, to make them freeze just for a bit and make them appreciate that aspect of the offense.
And the freshman, Dontrevious Robinson, made the most of that, picking up 4 yards. They had two eye backs on the field. And on second down, they come back with Burkhead.
Third three.
And again, they're moving toward that third and short, which is exactly what Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator, wanted here tonight. There is Sean over on the far side. Many of you realize he worked for a long time with Gary Barnett, and Barnett was the head coach of Colorado. Fine young man. He and Tom Osborne had some long conversations about bringing a little bit more power into this offense, something that Tom certainly knows something about as coach, now the athletic director. So here is that third and two, a manageable third down for the Huskers. And Zach, straight back, has time, fires complete, got the first down. And that is Paul, Niles Paul, the receiver, and that's textbook.
That is. This is what they want to do with this offense. And Paul is their most athletic receiver, but this time he's just going to settle in right where the linebackers are, find an empty spot. But this is why they want it. It's second and six and third and two, because they got that first down by half a yard. They need every yard they can get to give themselves a chance to be effective, as Tom Osborne looks on, very happy to see what's happening here in the early part of this game.
Hello is back with Lee. Option. Lee keeping it all the way. Didn't get much, and we will get a lot here. We'll go to New York and Matt Weiner, Matt.
All right, Brent, I'll do what I can. This Verizon Wireless update from Tampa. Georgia Tech trying to win its first outright ACC title since 1990. That's Jonathan Dwyer to give them a 10-7 lead. And the old Jackets just turned Clemson over. They've got the ball back and the lead.
And Matt, here, two Nebraska field goals following interceptions thrown by Colt McCoy, and the Cornhuskers lead it 6-0 with 2:57 to go in the opening quarter.
Got a free play here
in the middle of that defensive line that time, and so Helu try to get six if he can. And
offsides, defense, interior lineman, 5-yard penalty. Pete, second down.
This is what they need to be able to execute. And, you know, I think Zach Lee's been an interesting story this year. Young man who was thought to really be a strength for this offense, struggled against Texas Tech and especially Iowa State, was benched the following week, came back to finish the game against Oklahoma, and has played very well in their last three games. And just kind of managing the game and making good decisions.
Second down and three. Young, tight end, goes in motion, and the back slipped. And the reason why he slipped is Kendall was headed from his direction. Sergio Kendall, number two. And when he appears on the radar screen, folks, is all you can say.
Especially when you don't block him. If you're not going to block Sergio Kendall, he will explode into the backfield. And Helu did not have a chance. And instead of being in that third to short, now they're in a little bit of a tougher situation to execute against this Texas defense. See if Will Muschamp decides to get creative with a blitz package or a rush three and drop eight into coverage.
Gillian is the slot receiver on this third and seven. He's at the top of your screen. Comes back near side, high, incomplete, and this time Nebraska will be forced to punt. And Alex Henry, who's a very good positional punter, and this year he has been burying teams inside the 20. 26 of his 65 punts. Inside the 20-yard line. Young man at practice, and then earlier today was, of course, every punter who comes in here has got to take a crack at Jerry's big replay board. And after hitting it, along with the Texas punter, they were both warned by the PA announcer, that's a no-no. Fourth down and seven. Shipley is back deep. Fair catch. Inside the 10-yard line at the nine. So he buries the Horns back inside that 10-yard line in this battle of field position. There's their drives. You can see the two interceptions leading to field goals and punting. They have not done much here.
I'm going to be very surprised if the adjustment from Greg Davis out to Colt McCoy isn't to run the football, to try to take control of the line of scrimmage and try to run at the strength of Nebraska's defense, which is their defensive line. They're going to have to be able to do that to be able to get any kind of rhythm going right now with this offense.
Going to do just that with Newton. Edge on the outside, Amu Kamara. He's already got an interception here tonight. He's made a couple of tackles, and he makes another stop.
And Bo Pelini, like any defensive mind, wants to make a team one-dimensional so then he can get creative and exotic with his blitz packages. One way to make them not be able to make you one-dimensional is get a little bit more committed to trying to run the football. Make them respect that aspect of your game.
This time Colt will keep it himself. Big gap on the left to the 30-yard line and a first down for the Longhorns. McCoy, of course, many of you saw on that Thursday night exploding 65 yards for a touchdown. Here's 14, Irby. And they come right back. And it is the run play. And Newton picks up 9 yards on first down.
Here we go. Three straight plays running the football. Now they get their tempo going. They pick up a first down. They're trying to get Nebraska on their heels.
And Newton slips. And that'll bring up a third down. Trey Newton, his daddy, believe it or not, Nate, who was an offensive lineman and a big rascal for the Dallas Cowboys. You might remember him. Yeah. Clearly, Trey takes after his mom.
<You're right. laughs>
They're down and four now. stoppage here with the officials. The field judge is coming in to our referee, back judge, I should say.
The 40-second clock should not be running. It's correct.
Final seconds of the opening quarter. Third down and four.
Keep an eye on Jordan Shipley here. It's his go-to man on third and short.
Comfortable in the slot. McCoy looks away. Comes back to the flat, and they lose yardage on that play. Newton is hit by Philip Dillard, perhaps the best lineman at Nebraska. He's a senior from Tulsa, and he had the swing man all the way. As we come to the end of the first quarter here at Cowboys Stadium in Arlington, Texas, this presentation of the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship will return after this message and a word from our ABC stations. O'clock in the Central Time Zone, the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship. Nebraska leading on the strength of two field goals following two Colt McCoy interceptions. And now on fourth down, Nebraska will call back deep. Tucker blocked. They now have blocked the punt here on the Horns, and they're going to get the ball in Texas territory. Punt is blocked on the down at the 37-yard line, and Eric Martin, number 46 right there, blocked it for the Cornhuskers.
Well, this is amazing to see the rugby-style punt ever blocked, because that's why you usually do it. Coaches around the country have used this because it's effective in getting a good roll, and usually you don't even have to worry about that. But what an amazing effort that time by Martin, who worked around Nolan Brewster to be able to pick up another big play for Nebraska. Special teams and defense, the key for the Cornhuskers to give this offense a short field.
The junior from Danville, Lori Heller, back in as the I back. Play fake, and Zach is going to throw it. Going to go for it right after the block punt. Paul Battle, end zone, intercepted. Picked off by Williams. Aaron Williams, his third interception of the season. He picks it off, and it'll come out on the 20-yard line.
Well, Aaron Williams, the top defensive back. Bo Pelini electing to go after it after the big break. Going for the big play. Niles Paul has to slow down and wait for the ball. It gives Williams plenty of time. And for young defensive backs, Aaron Williams not only did a good job of turning his body, but he read the eyes of the receiver, Niles Paul. And when Niles Paul looked up for the football, that told Aaron Williams to look back. And a huge, huge play for Texas.
Shipley will open this series in the slot for Colt McCoy. Trey Newton is off to the quarterback's left. And they'll open with Newton behind the middle of the line, and a fine gain on first down here for the Longhorns.
And Craig Davis is seeing the same thing that we've been talking about. The adjustment to this matchup zone from the Nebraska defense is run the football.
They go quickly. McCoy has to throw it away. Under pressure from Pierre Allen that time, the junior from Denver, Colorado, was applying heat on the quarterback, and that leaves him with third down and four.
It's a contrast in styles defensively. Nebraska doesn't feel threatened by Texas and their running game. They're completely locked into Colt McCoy and his wide receivers. And, of course, Nebraska, when they're on offense, Texas's defense is locked in on their running game.
On third down, McCoy forced out of the pocket, comes in underneath. And that, of course, is to his buddy Shipley, who picked up the first down.
Dillard, the linebacker right here, is going to look up Jordan Shipley and just completely take him out of the play. The problem is Shipley's used to that. He makes an adjustment. Colt McCoy buys a little bit of time, but you can see the attention that Shipley demands, especially on third down. Good job working to get open.
This time, McCoy able to stay in the pocket, hits Buckner, and Buckner picked up about 8 yards on that pass play on first down. But it was the protection that time.
Yeah, Brent, and when you run the football, it has a tendency to slow down that talented defensive line. But Dan Buckner really has not been a big part of this offense since spraining his knee against Wyoming. The coaches said this week has been his best week of practice since that injury, and he can still be a big part of the offense.
Come back with Newton, and he is stoned. Talk about a stout defense as Gomes comes up and just ripped him down that time. The junior from Hayward, California, he has blitzed here tonight and put heat on McCoy. Now he comes up and makes that stop. Nebraska is built around this defense, and that, of course, is Bo Pelini's specialty, and it is really keeping it, this team, in the thick of things here tonight. McCoy will be back in a gun. Here's a third and two, and they go empty in the backfield, and they spread it out with five receivers.
There's some confusion there. Bo Pelini actually had to call the timeout. Looks like Cameron Meredith was trying to run off the field. Bo Pelini before the potential of having 12 guys on the field. Just miscommunication.
And one of the things he had to be concerned about when they spread that field is Colt McCoy taking off and running for the first down. That was something he was very concerned about. We've got that timeout now. Well, the USC defense had not allowed an opposing team to rush for 200 yards in 46 straight games. Vince Young did it all by himself in that classic. Play number one will be revealed at the Rose Bowl on January 1st. We'll begin at 4:30 Eastern on ABC. Third down and two. McCoy rolling to the right. And great coverage with Sue coming up at the end of that play. You can see number 93 was closing in, and Gomes again.
Kirkendall motioned to give a little bit of confusion potentially for Nebraska, and he's going to go out in the flat. Shipley's going to come out here, but I want you to look at the coverage and how dialed in this Nebraska defense is. Where can Colt McCoy go? He has nowhere to go with the football other than to just eat the football and lose the yardage. Great job of recognizing the routes again by Nebraska.
There might be a wrist injury here. He came off, and I think there's some pain down there. I think his head down, we could have a problem with Colt McCoy. This punt by Tucker is going to be marked at the 19-yard line. Let us, Herbie, take a look at this.
It's obviously towards the end of the play, after Gomes makes the play, big push by Sue, and he comes right down. We'll have to take a very close look at this when we come back.
Well, there's the championship trophy. They'll be awarded at the conclusion of this game to either Texas or Nebraska. Cornhuskers lead it by two field goals, and this is their backup eye back, the freshman from Plano, Texas, Rex Burkett. Herbie, let's go back and take a look at this collision by McCoy over on that sideline.
Meredith and Sue, a big, strong push there late. He goes into it in Nebraska, looks like staff member. Of course, Bo Pelini's fired up. But we watched him very closely when he came over to the Texas bench, wondering if there might be something seriously wrong. But it looks like, based on the way he's acting, he's okay. You can see the left wrist getting a little bit of extra attention.
Second and nine. Burkett not going far. When you look at the offensive output by Nebraska in this game, you say, can this defense hold up? They have only 35 yards of offense, 8 passing yards, and 27 rushing yards. Texas, on the other hand, has 65. Of course, both offenses have been stalled with 2 interceptions apiece. But now here comes the third down, and Nebraska's given no indication that they can come up with big plays of this kind on third and eight. So let's see what Zach Lee and the Cornhuskers were able to do here. Middle dropped, incomplete. Had Paul coming across. He was being chased by Shockey Brown.
Man coverage, Shockey Brown up against Niles Paul. The big thing here, in a route that takes this long, is you need time. There's the blitz. Good job of picking it up. Zach Lee has just enough time, but the ball snuck up and surprised Niles Paul. If Zach Lee would have had just a split second longer to throw the football, it would have given Paul enough time to be able to make that catch.
And the Huskers are now 1 of 6 on third downs. But the good news is the defense has held the Horns to 1 of 6 on third down. So Henry booms one. Shipley back to the 36-yard line. Trying to get wide on the left. And he is ridden down at the Texas 42. So we'll take a break. Texas fans quiet, and with good reason. MetLife is providing tonight's aerial coverage. Visit MetLife.com. Learn more about MetLife's long history of providing coverage at major sporting events. Cowboy Stadium, Arlington, Texas. Huge crowd on hand here tonight. Nebraska has always traveled well. Of course, many of Texas' finest fans live right in the neighborhood. First down and 10 for Colt McCoy. They trail it by 2 field goals. Here's Newton. Quickly follow. In that time, Asante and Steinkuhler along with Dillard.
Very impressed with the overall speed of this defense. We came in respecting their defensive line led by Sue, but the linebacker Phillip Dillard, and you're looking at a lot of times 6 defensive backs. Great versatility from Eric Hag and DeJuan Gomes tonight.
Second and 8, and Newton is slowed up. Busts off the first would-be tackler, and one of the few times we've seen a gain after somebody is hit. Asante finally cleans up on the play.
And if you haven't seen a lot of Nebraska this year, this isn't a shock necessarily. They're 3rd in the nation in scoring defense. If you go back to the year before Bo Pelini came to Lincoln, you know they're 115th in the nation in scoring defense. And 2 years later, they're 3rd in the nation in scoring defense.
Man knows defense, no question about that. Third down and 5 for McCoy. Remember, they are 1 of 6 on third down. Make it 1 of 7.
Prince, Amu Kamara here, the corner. Great job of sitting just at the first down marker. He knew that Marquise Goodwin was just looking to pick up an easy route and an easy first down. And Amu Kamara that time just sitting there waiting for him and did not continue to get depth. He stayed right at that marker waiting for Goodwin. Good job.
So Tucker back on the field for the Horns. And Paul is back deep, standing at the, well, Nebraska, let's make it the 15-yard line. That low line drive, bouncing punt. It'll go out of bounds, and we'll see where the officials are going to mark it. Inside the 20-yard line, a fine punt. We'll take a break. Low scoring here tonight, huh? The battle for the Big 12 trophy, which will be awarded tonight to either Texas or Nebraska. And right now, the Cornhuskers lead it by a couple of field goals. We have a huge crowd on hand here tonight at the Cowboys' gorgeous new facility. Nebraska's longest gain, Herbie, of the night is 7 yards. That was their first offensive play. Hello's 7-yard run. That's their longest play of the night. They come back with the running play, and they don't get that on first down. As we take a look at the Pacific Life game summary, defense, defense.
Defense, defense, and so far textbook for Nebraska to be able to pull off an upset. The takeaways that they had to come up with, they have 2 takeaways. The difference is they were able to generate some points. Average starting field position. They've been doing a great job of winning that battle. The discipline that they've played with throughout this game. They don't have a penalty yet tonight. It's exactly what they have to do against a team that has more ability in Texas.
See if the Huskers can get number 44, Mike McNeil, their tight end, involved here. He comes in their number 2 receiver. He's been quiet. Second down and 8. Zach is sacked at the 9-yard line. Acho, Sam Acho, number 81, with his 9th sack of the season. One of the Acho brothers.
And Roy Helu, the tailback 10, tries to come up with a block, but Acho is too quick off of the football.
I don't think Kalu expected Acho to get upfield in such a hurry. He recognized that it was play action. Not play action, just recognizing the quarterback rolling towards him. But Roy Helu that time not doing a very good job of taking the right angle to come up and being able to slow down Sam Acho.
Robinson into the backfield. Third and 17, and that brings the Horn fans up. Quarterback draw just to gain a couple of yards, and then they'll punt it away. Kendall and Sam Acho again bringing the heat, and there's just nothing doing with this offense.
This is why they need a short field to work with tonight. They have 29 yards on the night. Total offense. This will be the first time that Texas is going to get great field position for Colt McCoy.
So Shipley standing near midfield. He hangs one real high. Fair catch, but it's in Nebraska territory. This time, McCoy will start at the 42. And all right, Herbie, here you come, lad. Tonight's Aflac trivia question, it's a toughie. Colt McCoy had 304 pass and 175 rush. Who are the other two quarterbacks with 300-plus pass and 150-plus yards in a game?
Number one, that is a great question.
There's two others.
And I've heard of them both, right?
Oh, you know them both. One of them you might not remember right off the bat. I think that this was the tough one. We brought the heat tonight.
Time to get the championship. Don't hurry. You bring it.
On first and 10 now, it's up to McCoy, and this time he's brought down for a loss. And rolling in on him was Barry Turner, the senior from Tennessee. What an outstanding defensive front these two teams have. Both of them are outstanding.
Yeah, they're dominating the line of scrimmage and making it very tough for Colt McCoy and Texas to execute along with Zach Lee. I mean, look how quick they're able to get penetration. And again, Colt McCoy doesn't have anywhere to throw the football to. He's talked so much about Malcolm Williams and Kirkendall growing and developing. Right now, they're not having a chance to show that development.
Second and 14. McCoy stands middle and a little short of the first down, but complete to Shipley, his roommate and longtime buddy.
Well, that time, both linebackers went wide, and it was the first time tonight that the middle of the field opened up for Colt McCoy, and Shipley, of course, is able to find that hole. Go back to something Greg Davis told us this week, and he said because of appreciation for Nebraska's style of defense, he said being patient is going to be a very important thing for us as an offense.
Lamar Houston comes in as the fullback, and Cody Johnson, the short yardage running back for the Horns, as they'll go power to pick it up, and the big fella does. Right around the 30-yard line. So the Horns on the move here now with another first down.
Bring the big fella in when you need the short yardage. I think this is something that can help Texas and their offensive line because Sue and Crick, Allen, Turner, really whipping them up front. And sometimes you pick up a first down and you start to become the aggressor.
From the 31, Colt kept it, and Sue threw him for a loss of a yard. And Dominican Sue, who's going to pick up a lot of hardware, undoubtedly he's the leader in all the categories for Defensive Player of the Year.
Well, he fights right through Chris Hall, and he doesn't give up on the play. Look at him. He's fighting off Chris Hall with his left arm, and he wraps up Colt McCoy with his right arm. Look at him fighting off. He's being held, and he still has that right arm with a clothesline to bring in poor Colt McCoy. Woo.
Young man from Portland, Oregon. Quick strike, great grab. First and 10, and going up for it was Malcolm Williams.
Amu Kamara, the corner, tried to get physical, but give Malcolm Williams a lot of credit that time as a big target at 6'3". He's able to work free and get to the inside. The first time we've seen a receiver break away from the coverage, get to the inside and make it easy for Colt McCoy on the throw.
Fozzie Whitaker checks in as the running back. He is to McCoy's right. gets the call. Can he get the edge? He cannot. And tackling in space is a specialty. That is Matt O'Hanlon, the senior from Nebraska. And watch this tackle in space. Textbook.
That's beautiful. It looked like Whitaker might be able to pick some yards up because he outran Phillip Diller to the corner. But how about Matt O'Hanlon, who's been a playmaker all year for the Huskers defense, coming up again and making a great play.
Now second and 10. Newton's the check down receiver. McCoy rolling hard out of bounds. Barry Turner in pursuit, and here comes third down.
Nowhere to go again that time for Colt McCoy. This defense, very well schooled in what to expect from the routes and the route adjustments from Colt's group of wide receivers. And as good as Colt McCoy is, Brent, because of this route recognition, everybody is covered by a red jersey, and the only thing he has left to do is try to create.
Third and 13. Texas empties out the backfield. McCoy fires end zone. Penalty is called. Buckner was the receiver, and the defender was Eric Hag, and the penalty flag is thrown.
Pass interference, defense from the 25. The foul's in the end zone, the ball replaced in the 2-yard line. First down.
It's number 28. Yeah.
Eric Hag is on coverage. Brent, he's in great position, but because he did not turn around to recognize where the football was, the officials will call pass interference every single time, and Texas catches a break and gets a good opportunity here now inside the 5-yard line.
And the officials confer here.
The previous spot was on the 19-yard line. 15-yard penalty puts the ball on the 4.
And there it will be for first and goal. And what Pelini wondered is why wasn't that half the distance? First down and goal from the 4. Newton to the 2, and it will be second down and goal. Gomes making another stop. You would think that pretty soon we'd see Cody Johnson come in this situation, and they would go power. And here he comes, the sophomore from Waller, Texas.
Still 3 wide receivers in the game, along with the big tight end, Greg Smith.
And they put him to McCoy's left rather than work out of the eye with the lead fullback. And they're going to give it to the quarterback behind him, and McCoy trying to get to the end zone. Touchdown! The first touchdown of the evening.
Colt McCoy following Cody Johnson's block on Phillip Dillard, and then he just has to fight for every single inch to be able to pick up this first down. It's one of the few times we've seen Texas get a push on that Nebraska front 4.
Hunter Lawrence to give Texas the lead. And I believe they're going to look at it upstairs just to make sure that it broke the plane. So they want just a little bit more time. Not a challenge, it was simply the replay booth as they replay every play. They wanted just a little bit more time to see if McCoy broke the plane for sure. So let us take a few more looks here as he was barging in. The helmet clearly seemed to get across, and hard to see the football down there.
It's tough to see the football, and does his knee touch, or is it
sort of on top of bodies in there now? Oh, hang on. That might be a little bit of a definitive look down there, huh?
It could have been.
We'll see.
You know, his knee never touches. It's just that he comes down right at the goal line, and they're going to have to make an evaluation and decide whether or not, when he comes down, did the ball break the plane? Not the helmet, but the football.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown.
Well, after that 31-yard punt by Nebraska, Herbie, that was only a 42-yard drive, and that is certainly what the Longhorns needed.
Yeah, it's been a game of field position for both these teams. With the offenses struggling, when they've had their opportunities within pretty good field position, they've been able to capitalize. But think about if you're Bo Pelini, Nebraska, if this ends up being 7-6 at the end of this first half, as well as they have played, to still be down potentially at the half.
Tanner Lawrence. But it has been one-sided excellence.
Yes.
The Nebraska offense has only 29 yards. They're going to help out.
Yes, they do.
Well, you get four Aflac stars if you nail this one. So, Herbie, here's my answer sheet.
Okay.
Oh, there you are. Okay. Would you have gotten Marcus Tuivasa-Sopo? I thought you might get Woody Dance.
I would have gone Charlie Ward or maybe Vince Young.
Vince Young? I thought that's who I guessed. Yeah. I'd forgot.
I thought you were
Tuivasa-Sopo out of Washington.
We're in Dallas with the Longhorns.
We double-crossed you.
You did.
It was not fair.
No. I'll prep.
I'll be fair in Pasadena.
I'll be ready.
I promise.
Okay. I mean, you made it the whole universe, every team in the country.
But you're my all-universe analyst. Yeah. It is fielded on the five by Marlowe now for the Cornhuskers. And he is down at the 26-yard line. So there they are. And what a night McCoy had against Texas A&M. I'm going to make a point right now because everybody thought that McCoy elevated himself to number one on the Heisman list. It is my feeling here tonight, Mr. Ingram stood very tall in that win by Alabama today over Florida. He rushed for 113 yards and three touchdowns. We got a horse race. They're going to vote electronically. And I feel that the majority of votes will be made tomorrow after this weekend of games. I know I haven't voted.
I haven't either. I'll vote tomorrow.
First down and 10. Zach Lee will hand it off to Rex Burkhead, and let us go to New York and Matt Weiner. Matt.
All right, friends, speaking of Heisman candidates, SportsCenter right now, presented by Best Buy. Alabama's Mark Ingram put up 189 total yards and scored three times for Alabama, who never trailed the Florida in winning the SEC championship. They're on their way to the BCS national title game. And moments ago, Scott Blair connected on that 28-yard field goal. Georgia Tech leads the ACC championship at the half, 16-13.
And here, Matt, Colt McCoy is 9 of 16, and he has two interceptions. And the Huskers still not able to move the football.
Let's go back to something you said heading into the last break about, you know, I said, hey, Nebraska's doing about everything they can do to stay in this game, and yet they're going to be down at the half. And we talked about being one-sided. Their defense is doing it. This offense coming into this game is conservative by nature, and they have to be willing to get away from that to be able to move the football. Will Muschamp's defense is attacking downhill into the running game. And if they're not going to break some of those tendencies, they're not going to have a chance to move the ball.
The Cornhuskers have two first downs here tonight. This is third and 7. And they still have only two first downs, so they'll have to punt it away. Now, Colt McCoy will have just inside of a minute.
Now, if Bo Pelini were up here, he would say, listen, I've got to win this game with my defense and with special teams and winning the field position battle, and I'm asking my offense just not to lose the game, and the fact that we're in the game is allowing me to stay with that mindset. Now, once you get down, then, of course, you've got to change. But he's trying to just stay in this game.
You've got to have first downs. Yeah. You can't stay in this game without first downs. All right. Alex Henry back to punt. What a great leg he has, huh? Shipley's going to have to let this one bounce, and let's see where they mark it. At about the 32-yard line. Well, coming up on the Capital One halftime report, John and Jesse Palmer will have all the day's big highlights. Jesse's alma mater took a big blow, and you couldn't help but feel sorry for Tim Tebow and his his big effort to get back to another championship game as you look down on the house that Jerry built. Isn't it interesting, folks, what a $1.2 billion can buy you these days? Look at that. Boy, I've never had such a replay monitor as I have in this stadium.
How about the concourses? It took me 20 minutes to get from the field up to find the booth. Got lost.
Now McCoy back. Knocked and sacked back at the 22-yard line. Ndamukong Suh. What a presence.
If this defense can keep playing like this for four quarters, they're going to be able to hang around. This is another great film for the NFL experts to be able to break down, just overpowering Michael Huey in this offensive line. I mean, to take him on one-on-one, it's just not fair to ask the junior Huey to match up with Sue.
2.5 sacks here already.
You know what? The other thing about him is his awareness. He leads the team in tackles.
Herbie, they put together the hardware list.
Give them all to him. It's a clean.
Look at that.
It's a clean slate.
He could win.
Give them all to
every
him.
Every one of those. He's just having one of those phenomenal, unworldly type seasons.
His big prize will come
in April. I think has him listed number one.
His big prize will be in April.
Kuiper has him number one on the big board.
Yeah. That's the big trophy.
Because, you know, defensive linemen, the NFL will go for those rascals along with left tackles and quarterbacks. Those are the positions that they certainly look for. And how about this, Herbie? At the halftime, we've got the Dr. Pepper throw for scholarship dough. Got a couple of lady finalists, and they're going to go head-to-head for a chance to take home $123,000 tuition. Down in Atlanta today, a young woman upset a young man.
Wow.
And she picked up $123,000 down there.
Impressive.
It was very impressive.
Well,
she was steady. You know, the young man was firing. He was firing those balls up there. And she just kind of took her time. And
just shot put.
Down.
Just a little shot put.
So there we are. There you can see how well this Nebraska defense is playing here tonight. And they rank right up there with the Alabamas. You know, after our first game, you and I talked about how good Saban's
way back early September
defense was. Uh-huh. And I think Nebraska ranks right up there with it.
I think a lot of people wondered if they put stats up against average offenses and would they get exposed a little bit tonight. But, man, I think they're making a statement that they are one of the top defenses in the country. This defense is outstanding.
Is that inside shuttle pass? And Newton breaks free. Breaks the daylight. And stepped out at that first down marker. Fine move by Trey Newton, the redshirt freshman.
It's the second time this play has worked for Colt McCoy because of the quickness of the defensive line and the fact that they're just pinning their ears back coming after Colt McCoy. You flip it underneath to Newton, and he has plenty of room. If he can make one linebacker miss, he's going to get upfield. That was a big first down here. They're thinking points.
14 yards on that third and 13. They've got 15 seconds to work with. Now he'll try to strike. Far side, coming back is Shipley. That should be another first down. Clock will stop briefly, but they've only got 8 seconds. They've got to hurry.
Got to call a timeout. He's got two timeouts left. Get a timeout here. Still have one to work with.
Goodwin, the speedster, is available to Mac Brown, number 84, if they wish to try and strike. I guess with 8 seconds, Herbie, can they work the sideline and use that timeout and get the field goal unit
if they get downfield
shorter than the end zone?
Yeah, the great thing is the experience of Colt McCoy here. And because you have the one timeout, you know, you don't necessarily have to get to the sideline. You can work wherever you feel you have the best matchup. And it's really when you're going against Nebraska's defense, it's winning one-on-one matchups. And if they're going to double-team Jordan Shipley, then Malcolm Williams or James Kuykendall's got to be able to get free against man-to-man coverage. But one timeout, you make about a 15-yard completion here, and you got a shot at a field goal.
Kuykendall, Shipley, Williams are the wideouts. Under pressure. It breaks down. Throws it out of bounds as time runs out here on the first half. So the Texas Longhorns will take a 1-point lead into the locker room. 7-6, and let's go down to Lisa.
Thanks, Brent. Bo, coming into this game, you said that you wanted to make them one-dimensional. How do you think your defense did in that half?
Well, I think we've been holding up on the run game pretty good. They got a couple, like a quarterback run on there where we blew an assignment, but not bad execution on our part.
Now, on the other side of the ball, just two first downs in that half. How do you generate some more offense?
Well, we got to go back to the drawing board and figure it out and get it. We got to knock them off the football a little bit we'll be okay. We're still in this football game. We're right where we want to be, and we got 30 minutes to go win this thing.
All right, thank you.
All right, Lisa, thank you. A one-point, low-scoring first half as we send it to the Times Square studio. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer for the Capital One Halftime Report. And we would like to congratulate the Dave Matthews Band for receiving two Grammy nominations, including their first Album of the Year nomination for The Big Whiskey and the Gru Grux King, as we welcome everybody back to the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship on ABC with Kirkstreet and Lisa Salters. I'm Brent Musburger. Very low-scoring first half. Colt McCoy limbering up. The Longhorns lead Nebraska 7-6. And Herbie, Nebraska had 10 offensive plays in the second quarter from minus 1 yard. Now, what can they do to change things here a little bit?
Well, you have to try to mix in some play-action passes. Otherwise, Texas is just going to load up, because really both offenses struggled. Colt McCoy couldn't get into any rhythm at all. Two interceptions eventually led to 6 points for Nebraska. Nebraska really had their way with Texas defensively, but eventually Texas caught a break, got great field position, and eventually got the touchdown to give them the lead. But neither offense right now has much footing, and I think you're going to see, I talked about it at the end of the first half, I think Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator from Texas, will continue to run the ball, and I think they're going to try to get the ball downfield to their outside receivers, Malcolm Williams and James Kirkendall, which if they can execute that, it can open up the middle of the field.
So Nebraska receives to start the second half. Tucker will kick it away. Paul and Marlowe are back deep. Marlowe runs up to the 5 yard line. Marlowe down at the 23 yard line, and let's check in down below with Lisa.
Well, Brent, Herbie, remember early in the season, Colt McCoy was pressing, and he spoke to me about that earlier this week. He said, you know what, I felt a lot of pressure. I came back for my senior year. I was the runner-up for the Heisman. I tried to do everything perfectly, and I just couldn't do it. Well, I started to wonder, perhaps the entire team, not just McCoy, was pressing tonight, knowing what's at stake. Mack Brown said to me just at the half, that's exactly what's going on. He said, the second quarter, we settled down a bit, but we were way too tight that first half.
Interesting.
Zach Lee starts it off, and here's Helu. Helu has the longest play from scrimmage, and that was a 7 yard run, and that was their first offensive play of the game. So Helu behind the left side of the line with a good looking run here to start the second half.
Brent, it's sad when a 6 yard gain, and you and I are high fiving up here saying, now we go. Now we're executing Nebraska. But a big block that time by Ben Cotton, the tight end, and the left tackle.
In that first half, both quarterbacks threw two interceptions apiece. Helu is right behind him. Kenny is spread out to the left of the bottom of your screen here on second down and 4. Helu on a cutback, and it'll be third down and short as Lamar Houston makes the stop, and we take a peek at the Pacific Life game summary.
We've talked a lot in this first half about how the offenses have struggled, and the numbers do not lie. The sacks by Nebraska, it really put a lot of pressure on Colt McCoy. That'll have to continue, but at least they're in a position here. Brent, you talked about it, third and short, and how with this offense, how important that is for them to try to maybe build a little continuity and try to sustain a drive.
They call a timeout. The clock was winding down on them, and they were forced to call a timeout on a third and 1. Well, ESPN's Monday Night Football is in the frozen tundra of Green Bay. 8:30 Eastern, and the Packers will take on the Baltimore Ravens. And speaking of defense, the Ravens make a pretty good living out of that. And Rodgers has come alive a little bit for the Packers. Down the stretch, they're still, both these teams, thinking about a playoff. 8:30 p.m. Eastern time. So here's your third down and short coming up for Nebraska. The Cornhuskers winning the Big 12 North. They wound up with a record of 9-3.
Nebraska has had 8 third down opportunities and only able to convert one so far.
Option look. Lee's going to keep it. Barges toward that first down.
Spot looks a little bit short there. He's trying to eventually just stretch the play and then follow Mike Smith, 65, and be able to pick up a first down, but he's about a yard short, half a yard to a yard short. It's tough to get wide against the speed of this Texas defense.
Alex Henry and Bo Zampano, let's go.
The 13-29, please.
I think Bo just as soon would like to see his defense on the field the way they're playing. It's almost as if they're playing with a better chance of scoring than the Nebraska offense is.
There's a little bit of an exchange over there on the far side between Bo and Zach. There is a freshman quarterback behind Zach who has played this year. He started 2 games. Cody Green is out of Dayton, Texas. And Shipley will let this one go out of bounds, and we'll see how far up the line they're going to come, and they're going to mark it right about the 36-yard line. That's only a 31-yard punt. Colt McCoy and the Longhorns will have an opportunity when we come back. So Texas first possession here of the second half, leading Nebraska 7-6 in the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship. Texas win would send them into the BCS Championship game against Alabama. A Nebraska win would spell BCS chaos. First down and 10. McCoy steps off to the left. There's a penalty flag thrown on this play. Shipley battles for a first down, but the umpire threw it immediately.
Where he threw it, either a chop block or a hold against Texas. Remember, they called a chop block earlier.
Personal foul, chop block, offense number 71. 15-yard penalty, repeat first down.
That's his second, Chris Hall.
Chris Hall attempting to get out to Ndamukong Suh again, very first play of the game. The center just moving off to his right, trying to get to Suh in the attempt there. What the official, the umpire right away came up with and called. Did make contact on his right knee. Didn't take him down.
You're right, Herbie. Their defense does produce more yardage.
I think they have a better chance of scoring with Suh and the boys out there.
First down and 25. Here's the handoff. Newton trying to stretch the defense. And, you know, I alluded to the fact that the black shirts, and that goes way back to Coach Charlie McBride, who rewarded defensive stars with black shirts. They would show up at practice with a black T-shirt on. And so ever since McBride started that tradition at Nebraska, the defense has been known as the black shirts throughout college football. And this would make Coach McBride and Coach Osborne and everybody else who's come through that great program very proud the way they have played here tonight. They have been awesome. Second down and 23. And McCoy back, going to throw and has to take off. Receivers recovered, and he is thrown down by Ndamukong Suh. Ndamukong is dominating. Wow.
Get great coverage here by this Nebraska defense. Amu Kamara, the defensive corner here, 21, sitting right on Malcolm Williams. That's exactly where Colt McCoy wanted to go, but because of the coverage, watch Suh fight through this double team. Chris Hall trying to help out with Michael Huey, actually pushed Huey off of Suh, and then it was a one-on-one battle, which Suh will win every time.
That's 3.5 sacks for Suh. Here comes Newton as on this third down. Texas pick up a few yards and then send the punter into the game. Asante, the safety, over to make the stop. But I can see why he's rated number one on Mel Kiper's big board.
Brent, we came into this game thinking that Colt McCoy had a chance to maybe put an exclamation point on a Heisman campaign, and we've heard all year that if a defensive player should ever win it, Ndamukong Suh should be up there, 3.5 sacks, and he's got a lot of more opportunities tonight.
So now Herbie is putting him in the Heisman conversation.
Might as well.
And Paul is back deep. Tucker booms one. Fields it at the 28-yard line. Slips a tackle. Made the most out of that. Battling for a couple of yards. And boy, I'll tell you, Bevo's, come on, lads, come on. This thing's putting me to sleep. Got timeout. Well, they have tours for the public here, and they take groups out at $15 a head, and you should see the number of folks who have gone through. The innards of this stadium are worth seeing, I might add. The best control room I've seen any place short of Cape Canaveral. And a run now is Zach Lease, and chasing him with Sergio Kendall.
Great heads-up play here by Kendall. Finally, we see a play-action pass from Zach Lee, and Will Muschamp having Kendall and his Texas defense dialed in to the potential of that play-action pass being called. They went with a bootleg trying to get Texas out of position, but the Horns all over it, and Kendall chasing down Lee there, almost came up with a sack. See, that's a play right there that's not going to show up, and some people want to say, how come he doesn't have more sacks, but yet he's very effective.
On second and 10, screen incomplete. Helu, the running back, and Cornhuskers are lucky, Herbie, this one wasn't picked off on them.
Yeah, Brent, the timing of this is off right away. I mean, Zach Lee didn't even have a chance to set his feet, and then already he's dealing with Ben Alexander, Lamar Houston, and the Texas front in his face. So that play didn't have a chance from the very beginning.
Nebraska is 1 of 9 on third down. Texas D licking its chops. Deflected again, and this one is intercepted. Picked off at the 35 by middle linebacker Roderick McElroy. There's a young man who had 17 tackles against Texas A&M, and now he comes up with the third interception against Zach Lee.
Lamar Houston, an outstanding performer this year for Texas, right there gets his right paw on the football. Second straight deflection for the undersized Zach Lee, and a good awareness and a good job just sitting there reading the quarterback's eyes, spying him, waiting to make a play. The ball goes into the air, and this time Texas capitalizes.
Here's the handoff, and Newton goes for the edge, and he'll be stretched and out of bounds. Abu Kamara played very well from that corner position. Not afraid to come up against the run. Has an interception here tonight. It is second down and 5 coming up. Newton tonight has rushed for 38 yards. McCoy has thrown for 97. Not much doing there. Gomes up again from the secondary.
The versatility.
I see that up on that side.
Yeah, there
that's Sherrod Harris. That's, let me check that. I mean, that's Cody Green is what I mean. I was looking at the Texas youngsters down there. There is Cody starting to loosen up on that sideline.
Talked about how he stepped in middle of the year after the Iowa State game. Became the starter as a true freshman. See if he maybe eventually gets into this game.
McCoy is stripped down by Matt O'Hanlon, the senior safety.
O'Hanlon is going to come off right here. Nobody picks him up. They actually show the blitz, and I think the confusion and again. They're showing it and then dropping one guy at the, right as the ball is snapped. O'Hanlon has had a great game tonight. Gomes has had a great game. Eric Hag, Larry Asante. These safeties and their versatility has given this Texas front just a nightmare to deal with because of the different looks that they continue to give them.
On fourth and 17, McCoy and the Horns are not going for, yes, they are, pooch punt. Several times he's been able to do that. This one's going to be down inside the five-yard line. Downed at the one as Jordan Shipley downs it right there. How's that for field position for Nebraska's offense?
Uh-oh.
New quarterback, Zach Lee, is taken out, and Cody Green, the freshman who grew up about, 30 miles north of Dallas in Dayton, Texas. And so you're the quarterback, and there's a penalty flag. So you're the quarterback, and they say, go out and save it for us. And, oh, by the way, you're starting back at your home
ball.
1 yard.
Ball right. Start. Offense, number 81.
Oh, man.
That position for the goal. Still
now you're
down.
Back at your...
Inside your 1 yard line?
Exactly.
All right, Cody, get out there, and just like we did in practice, get it done. We've got 41 yards of offense and 2.5 quarters. Make it happen, kid. Let's go.
Quarterback sneak. We battled for a couple of yards.
Well, one thing we know, Cody Green right now has to be able to come in and give this offense a spark. Zach Lee, 2 of 13 before he took a seat next to Sean Watson and Bo Pelini. But, you know, it's not all Zach Lee's fault. I mean, this is an offense that came in knowing that they'd be swimming upstream because they just did not have the ability to throw the football. Very predictable running style of offense. It's the other thing that kind of messes the linemen up, the tight ends, the rhythm of the cadence with a new quarterback coming into the game. Two of his first three plays, we've seen legal procedure.
Now let's see what Sean Watson whistles up here on 3rd and 5 against Will Muschamp's defense. Late substitutions from both sides.
We're either going to see his first pass of the night or a very conservative call, potentially a punt deep in their own territory. Play clock's down to 2.
Got it off. It's going to be a play action from his own end zone. Throws high, almost intercepted. Gideon took a shot at it on the far side. He already has one pick here tonight, and Nebraska will punt it away.
A tough deal for Cody Green to deal with. The line actually does a pretty good job off the play action of giving him some time, but he throws this football a little bit too far for the tight end Cotton to be able to handle, and Nebraska very fortunate that Gideon did not come up with his 5th interception of the season.
Now Jordan Shipley figures to give Texas some excellent field position here against Henry. Working with a short field. So let's go back now to the top of the day. Alabama upsetting number 1. They will play for the BCS championship. Who will play them? If Texas wins, they figure to be invited to the BCS championship at Pasadena. But if Nebraska comes back and wins this, it is going to be a nail biter between TCU and Cincinnati. Remember, TCU is already done with their regular season, unbeaten, and Cincinnati in dramatic fashion rallied to beat Pittsburgh today in a snowstorm in Pittsburgh. An extra point was the difference. Marty Gilliard had 256 return yards for the Bearcats in that game. Now McCoy couldn't find a receiver. He'll throw it away, and it will be 2nd down.
Again, this Nebraska defense, Brett, is doing such a good job of mixing up their looks. They've put in at times 5 defensive backs, sometimes 6 defensive backs, sometimes as many as 7 defensive backs. And when you're asking 7 defensive backs to play on early downs, it requires, again, the versatility to come up and be good in run support and also be able to play man coverage or play in zone in pass coverage.
2nd down, handoff to Newton. four or five Nebraska defenders there. They pursued under Bo Pelini. You've got two of the best defensive coaches working in this game. Bo Pelini, the head coach of Nebraska, and Will Muschamp on the other sideline. Of course, he worked with Nick Saban. Now, there is Bo. Bo spent some time in the NFL with three teams, including the Green Bay Packers. And he has been the defensive signal caller for a national champion down at LSU. And it is a remarkable defensive turnaround for Nebraska. You can only imagine what this team would be accomplishing if they had a little bit stouter offense. And McCoy got one-on-one. Williams over the top, incomplete. And suddenly it is fourth down again as the defense of Nebraska keeping them right in this football game.
Yeah, the defense has very little margin of error tonight because they're not getting a lot of support. But Texas is in that uncomfortable position where do you go for it? Do you kick the field goal or do you have the pooch punt like we saw last play or last time they had the football from Colt McCoy?
So the defensive personnel has to stay on the field and there's no one back deep. Remember the last punt by McCoy was downed on the one and he pooches it again. This one will be down inside the 10-5. Stop there at the 4-yard line. And now it'll be inside the 5-yard line again.
Texas will play this game all night. I mean, even if they're not getting points, they're just putting this Nebraska offense that at this point has been inept back inside their own 10-yard line, and now they're winning and dictating the field position battle because there is no way, unless Texas has a mental breakdown, that Nebraska is going to drive over 90 yards and score potentially a touchdown or even get in field goal range.
Zach Lee is back, number 5. Roy Heller is the eye back. And might have been a false start.
You got the tight end again, Ben Cotton.
False start. Offense, number 81. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
I don't know if that's the loud end of the stadium here, but that's the second time to start a drive the last two series that Nebraska has had a problem with the snap count, and in both times it's been Ben Cotton out at the tight end position. For an offense that is struggling, the last thing that you can afford to do is start back at now first and 15. Now you're inside your 5-yard line.
And another flag. False start.
False start. Offense, number 80. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
Ryan Hill, who came on the field.
That's exactly what Bo Pelini cannot imagine. You can't afford to do this. Any offense can't afford to do it. But and look at this. Look at the numbers. 46 yards of total offense. We've got 6 minutes to go here in the third quarter.
Hello. To the 4. Matt, come in here from New York and show us some offense, my friend.
Yeah, we've got a little in the ACC Championship game. SportsCenter right now presented by Best Buy. Mostly the offense comes on the ground for Georgia Tech, which makes the pass so effective. Josh Nesmith to Demaryius Thomas, 70 yards and held up under review scrutiny. And it's a 10-point lead for Tech, who just picked off Clemson now, winding up in the third quarter.
50 points, is that what I saw there? And,
I dare to dream.
13 here. And Burkhead.
You know what Nebraska's mission statement is on this drive? Just don't turn the football over. You stay within a point, stay within one possession, but just don't self-destruct. Zach Lee, you cannot throw the ball into coverage. Running backs, hold on to the football. Last time they were third down, young Cody Green was in there. They took a chance and threw the football, and Blake Gideon almost came up with an interception.
Gideon is slotted to the right, and Lee, from his own end zone, drops it off the middle. Complete, but well short of the first down. So on trots Henry again, and his last three punts have not been that scintillating. 31, 39, and 31 yards. So Shipley is standing in Nebraska territory right now as Henry's been unable to boom one here. Trying to get it up in the air and allow coverage to get down. He does just that, and Shipley will fair catch it back on the Texas side of the 50-yard line. Well, we want to thank MetLife for providing today's dramatic coverage. MetLife has the protection you need for the most important ifs in your life. Visit MetLife.com today as you look down on the Cowboys' spectacular new palace. They put about $105,000 in for the Cowboys opener, and I dare say we are close to 80-some here tonight in this spectacular building. At least the fans have been comfortable with the roof and the doors closed. They haven't had much to cheer about on either side offensively, and McCoy takes off and slides safely with the first down.
This is how you attack a defense. It's matching up. Dillard instantly is going to follow the running back, Newton. Watch how there's nobody left in the middle of the defense. Makes it easy for Colt.
And they pick up the tempo a little bit, and Sue making a stop. Still another one for Nebraska.
So Colt McCoy has to be able to do, Brent, is great recognition and seeing Dillard instantly step out of that boxed area. There's nobody left there to spy on him. He's got to find a crease between his offensive line and, of course, the Nebraska defensive line, and you could pick up yards in a hurry.
Second and 10, pressure. Williams had to throw it away. He had no chance. Was that ball catchable?
It sure didn't look like it, but a flag came down. It's like they're going to call pass interference.
Defense, number 21, 15-yard penalty, first down.
I thought McCoy was throwing it away.
I think Bo Pelini, you and I, and everybody else watching the game.
Let's watch this. Williams is working.
And he gives up on the play. He's done. How's that pass interference?
I'm second guessing that call.
That's a very questionable call here.
But regardless, it gives the Longhorns a first and 10 against Nebraska.
Malcolm Williams wasn't even looking for the football there.
Macamara, McCoy was under so much heat that time, he just had to get it out of there. And there is a counter step by Newton. And guess what? Did not fool Sue. Took on the counter.
Well, they're trying to take advantage of the defense over pursuing, and Sue's right in the middle here. Watch what he does. You're going to try to come back. You're going to try to take advantage of the defense overflowing. He has such quickness and lateral movement. He comes right back with the running back and wraps him up.
Eight tackles, 3.5 sacks, demonstrating why he certainly is the defensive player of the year in college football. Second and 10. McCoy will slap it to Shipley. Sort of that middle screen, unable to bust it. Here comes a third down. Basante, the safety, with the stop.
Sante may have saved not only a first down, but even a bigger gain that time. Good job of recognizing Shipley coming from the outside in. Just enough there to take down Jordan Shipley and set up this third down. Forget McCoy here running the football.
McCoy straight back, waits, now comes back near side, and that one not a bounds. Williams again the intended target. Mukamara is holding up on that corner. Denard has certainly not been tested nearly as much
not
as
at all.
Prince has been.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. It seems like they've gone all night after Amu Kamara. 15 Denard on the other side hasn't had to hold up much at all. McCoy throwing the football to his right most of the evening.
So here's Hunter Lawrence. Shipley is his holder.
39-yarder is good. A four-point lead for Texas. Our attendance here tonight is 76,211. The fourth largest crowd in Big 12 championship history. And Herbie, just to make you feel good for some points, Montana 51, Stephen F. Austin nothing today.
I'll tell you what, Montana got a little bit of a scare last week. Now they're on fire, and what a big game next week with Appalachian State.
30 below in Montana next week, 6 inches of snow.
We will. No, okay, I was like, wow, 10-day forecast from Brent. Happy State.
High kick is fielded by Paul at the 5-yard line. Paul explodes looking for the big play. There is their best burst with the football all night. They only had 55 yards of offense.
You and I almost fell out of the booth. We were so excited this time to see Niles Paul hit a crease here against Texas. Get it away with a little bit of a hold there from one of his blockers, but he's able to show what he can do on not only special teams, but Niles Paul, I think, tonight, if Nebraska's going to get back in the game and have a chance to win it, this is the guy that they have to get the football into his hands. He's a playmaker.
43 yards on that return. That's a good news. The bad news is this offense has to go 52 yards. They haven't shown us they can do that yet. They are 1 of 12 on third downs here tonight. Here's the swing pass to Helu. Covered. Gets back to the original line of scrimmage. And, of course, the Big 12 Conference is affiliated with the Fiesta Bowl. And if Nebraska wins this, they would head there. But if Texas wins this and goes to the championship game, the Fiesta Bowl will wind up with the second pick, and they have a choice. And so the Dr. Pepper Big 12 update, that shows you the rest of the bowls, the Cotton and the Holiday and the Alamo and the rest of them. Second down and 10. Their biggest pass play of the night, and Brandon Kenny. And that is their first down since the opening quarter of this football game.
Great throw, but Brent, watch how Kenny works back to the football. By working back to the football, he was able to get to the inside of Earl Thomas, who looks like he's ready to make a play there, 12. But by coming back to the football, he gained a little bit of momentum and accelerated as he caught the ball, and that's what allowed him to get by Thomas and pick up the first down.
14 yards was the gain on that play. Now they come back with Burkhead. Hit by Lamar Houston.
Brent, you made a point about Mike McNeil, the tight end, who's been playing a lot of H-back tonight, number 44 for Nebraska. He's been shuffling in and out of the game. And whether it's McNeil or it's Ben Cotton, whoever ends up being in position, they've got to be able to stretch Texas's defense vertically with somebody. And if Niles Paul, the receiver...
They got time running down on him. Hurry, look at that again.
Another
third quarter.
But Brent, if Niles Paul's not going to do it, they've got to slip a tight end behind the coverage and try to get him the ball downfield.
Yeah, that would be something. Maybe they'll try that. This presentation of the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship return after this message and word from our ABC stations. Legendary coach and now athletic director of Nebraska, Tom Osborne. And Herbie, do you remember his former quarterback by the name of Turner Gill, who's doing so well at Buffalo?
Yes.
We were told tonight that he is the leading candidate for the Kansas coaching job. And what a great choice that would be. As down the near sideline, up in the air, incomplete. Second man in, great teamwork in that secondary. Thomas and Curtis Brown, and they jar it loose.
Well, I think initially Paul makes this catch. He gets around Brown, but watch Earl Thomas come over and separate him from the football. Great job by one of the top defensive backs in college football. Paul makes the catch behind Curtis Brown, and eventually Earl Thomas comes over to separate the football. Exactly, thought he finally had a big completion that he's been desperately looking for throughout the whole game.
Here's third and 10. Screen, nothing doing. Keenan Robinson, number one from Plano, Texas, makes the tackle.
He was waiting the entire time for Burkhead. Third down against this offense. You're thinking draw, maybe a screen. Eddie Jones gets his hand up, almost knocked the ball down. But this Texas defense, again, well-schooled. Jones misses it, but Keenan Robinson was fighting his way through Keith Williams the entire way and knew exactly where the ball was going.
Henry hangs one high for Shipley. Fair catch signal at the 10-yard line. So when we come back, we'll give you a Heisman Trophy update. How good is the Nebraska defense here tonight? Herbie, Texas was held to 8 yards. 8 yards of offense in the third quarter. And they're going to start now on their own 10-yard line. They lead it. They did have a field goal. They're up 10-6. To the left, incomplete, and a penalty flag is called again. I think the Texas bench helped with this call a little bit, and Bo is very upset. Eric Hag, the defender on Shipley.
Defense, number 29, 15-yard penalty, first down.
25, 29, eventually we'll get 28.
Brent, Eric Hag, second time that he's been called. He's in man coverage. The thing that continues to get him is he doesn't look for the football. And as an official, they're almost programmed. The contact is late, but he doesn't turn his head around until the football is already by him. And for an official, that's a quick sign right away to call pass interference on a defender.
First down and 10. Pump fake. Gonna go deep. Got Kerrigan. Complete. James Kuykendall was headed for the end zone and couldn't hold on.
Well, they finally went after Alfonso Denard, one of the first times tonight, Brent, and it's a double move. Kuykendall hesitated earlier in the route, and Colt McCoy gave it a little shoulder fake, and that's where Denard, being aggressive like the rest of this defense, started to come up to make the play. And he had exactly what he wanted. That's the matchup. Kuykendall just unable to hold on to the football.
Second and 10. Comes pressure. Gomes trying to get there. Can't. Incomplete. It is third down and 10.
This defensive line gets a lot of credit, and they should. But tonight, Bo Pelini and the secondary, and I'm talking about not just four guys, I'm talking about sometimes six and sometimes seven. They have matched up so well on the Texas offense and the routes, but also, Brent, they're giving them so many different looks. You're going to see it again right here. Third down, the four down linemen can get pressure, but they also like to bring pressure from seven Gomes a lot of times, too.
Penalty flag prior to the snap. The umpire's got a false start.
False start. Offense, number 63. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Michael Huey.
You know why he's moving? He's got Sue right across from him, trying to get a little bit of a head start on third and 10. A little nervous there.
If you're an NFL team, you could be looking at the surest thing that you're going to see as far as youngsters are concerned, and he's a defensive tackle. McCoy's going down again. That time, Crick along with Turner did the job, and McCoy a little bit slow getting up, and he's hobbling off just a touch.
Brett's third down and long. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 defensive backs in the game. Where is Colt McCoy going to throw the football? And when you combine that with a defensive line that's getting so much pressure, Colt McCoy doesn't have much of a chance.
Tucker standing back in the Texas end zone. Paul waits near midfield. Penalty flag. Line judge threw it. Believe he's got a false start on the horns.
False start. Offense, number 21, 5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Nebraska has stayed in the game despite all of their problems on offense. They have given themselves a chance as a two-touchdown underdog. Fourth and 28, coming down to 13 minutes. Tucker booms one. Paul's got it. Good field position coming up. 30, 25, Hunter to beat. Stretches free, still going. And it'll be first and goal for Nebraska. A 43-yard punt return.
Brent, you just made a point that this is what Nebraska wants, to be around in the fourth quarter. Some great blocks on a middle return. Eric Martin, who blocked a punt earlier, does a good job of picking up a block. And here again is Niles Paul getting into the open field. We saw it earlier on a kickoff return, setting up Zach Lee with about as good a field position as you could hope for the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
TCU and Cincinnati fans are on their feet. Burkhead will be the eye back. Burkhead picks up about a yard behind the left side. Smith and Williams blocking over there, and Ben Alexander makes the stop for the Horns.
Keep in mind, they cannot pick up a first down here. It's second and goal. This drive started right at about the 10-yard line, so you cannot pick up a first down. They've got to get this football into the end zone or settle for a field goal.
Burkhead is the eye back. And Dominican Sue is now the fullback, the lead fullback. And they knew it was coming in that direction. The Horns were ready for 93. Nolan Brewster and McElroy met the point of attack. They blew the play up.
That Nolan Brewster submarine Sue. He goes right underneath him. That's one way to deal with a big defensive tackle who's in to play fullback. But McElroy, Gideon, and Brewster that time blowing that play up. One for 13 on the night.
And a timeout has been called by Nebraska.
Nebraska. Second.
Facing a third and goal. A field goal, and they'd still trail by one, but they would be that much closer. If you're pulling for BCS chaos, this play is for you. Third down and goal for Zach Lee, and Nebraska to take the lead. He's back. Throws fade. Favre Turner. Paul's got it. Out of bounds. No. Side judge was right there. And Brandon Kinney, the intended target, number 84.
Great call by the official. Makes the catch. The left foot will come down first, and it does come out of bounds. Very, very close. Shockey Brown took a peek a little bit prematurely, and it allowed Kenny to get the separation, and Bo Pelini thought, come on. He even dropped his gum on that one. He's so fired up. Then he threw it.
Alex Henry to make it a one-point game. A 28-yarder. He does. We got a one-point game. 11 and a half minutes to go. We welcome you back to the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship. Just past the top of the hour, 11:34 to go, with Kirk Herbstreit and Lisa Salters. I'm Brent Musburger. Texas clinging to a one-point lead now. Kanalik will kick it off. Goodwin, the speedster, is back deep with Williams for the Horns. Line drive. Goodwin slips, and he's down. He's down right there at the one-yard line. The defense will be able to tee it up at the one-yard line. Take a look at this.
Well, the true freshman many times this year has been sensational for Texas, but this time just loses his footing as he's catching the football. The correct call being made there. And this is exactly what the Texas offense did not want to see for an offense that's been struggling the entire second half.
Colt McCoy trots back onto the field in this half. Colt McCoy has completed only one pass, but he has punted twice. Think about that for a minute now, what I just said.
Wow, that's... Hey, Brent, that replay that we just saw, he never had possession of the football when he went down and touched his knee.
There's a penalty flag, the referee. They have a false start.
Offense, number 24, half the distance to the goal. First down.
Lead back, Antoine Cobb.
Pushed it back about as far as it could go. You know, for those of you wondering who are Texas fans, you cannot review that play on the kickoff return.
First and 10, trying to get a little daylight, trying to come out from their own end zone here. As fine a defensive performance as you would ever want to see, especially when you consider the amount of time that they've spent on the field.
Brent, not only the time, because they don't look gassed or winded at all, but the fact that they're facing an offense, for the most part, has had its way going through the Big 12, putting up 43 points a game. And I know they've had some non-offensive touchdowns, but Colt McCoy, the last 5 weeks, has been on fire.
He's on second down in the end zone. It's close. No signal for safety. He was able to get the ball out. And Dominican Sue again.
Well, Huey and Chris Hall have had their hands full the entire game. This time, poor David Snow gets in on the act. Texas, very, very close to giving up a safety here. Getting Nebraska within. Sue made the play again. He's been all over the field.
Folks, when's the last time you saw in college now a defensive tackle dominate a football game like 93 has for Nebraska? Colt's going to throw it out from the end zone. Diving catch at the 15-yard line. He goes to his buddy Shipley. Maybe the biggest pass completion of the season for the Longhorns. 15 yards, and they move the chains coming out from their own end zone.
Well, the play created some confusion because Malcolm Williams went to the outside and went up like it was going to be just a look pass, a quick pass from Colt McCoy. It confused the Nebraska defense just enough for Shipley to wiggle through the secondary and find a crease.
Inside shuttle pass, the third time tonight, using Newton to the 20-yard line and picking up about 4 yards on that play before Sue and Crick bring number 23 down.
That's probably been the most consistent play that Colt McCoy in Texas has run. Three or four different times tonight, we've seen that little shovel pass to Newton, and it's picked up a lot of yards. It's all about taking advantage of Sue and the rest of that defensive line because of how quick they're getting the pass rush.
McCoy back on second down, fires complete. Out to the 36-yard line, Malcolm Williams. And that's a 16-yard gain. And for the first time tonight, Colt McCoy is starting to breathe fire in this offense.
He sure is. And that time he had just enough time to be able to deliver the football. And Malcolm Williams finally getting some separation from the Nebraska coverage, something we've not seen a lot of.
Going down again at the 30-yard line, and that was Ndamukong Suh hitting him first. And that should be the eighth sack of the night turned in by the Nebraska D.
Yeah, I think they might come up with a new rule for Suh. Can he count five steamboats before he comes in and puts pressure? This is almost getting unfair. He's just having his way with this offensive line. McCoy looked to go to Shipley, but because it was a long developing play, a double move, it requires a little bit more time to be able to throw that pass, and he didn't have the time.
Second and 16, he's going to put it up again. Deflected, incomplete. That was Hag, the defender. It was on Kirkendall, who was coming across.
Now, Brent, we've seen Malcolm Williams and James Kirkendall in the last two or three weeks really come on. And Colt McCoy and Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator, have talked about their growth this year and how it's taken pressure off of Colt and Jordan Shipley. But tonight, we've not really seen a lot from Kirkendall. We've seen a couple drops. And finally, the previous play, Malcolm Williams was able to make a catch. But this has not been a good night for the supporting cast of Jordan Shipley.
Now, Shipley is in the slot, his comfort zone on this third and 16. But McCoy is going to go sideline. Williams reaches up and grabs it near midfield for a first down on third and 16.
Third and 16, Brent. It's a double move. They bring pressure. Obviously, they're trying to get to him. Little bit of a shake, and you know what happened again to Denard? Watch. He gets beat off the line of scrimmage. Malcolm Williams uses his size at 6'3 to go up and over Denard at 5'10.
Quarterback draw. 8 yards, tough yards for McCoy.
Let's not forget where this drive started. This ball was way back inside their 1 yard line after the penalty. And Brent, you talked about a Heisman moment. And I know he doesn't have great numbers to talk about a Heisman, but this drive is huge for Colt McCoy, and it's the best he's been all night.
Still has to finish it off,
yes,
Herbie, against
yes,
a
sir.
Very tough D. Second down and two at the Nebraska 43. Inside handoff and nothing doing is Dillard. He was there as quick as a handoff on Newton, wasn't he? And here comes your third down again. And you look at the third down conversion for the Longhorns, only 5 of 16 tonight. Trotting in is Fozzie Whitaker. They will split him out wide. Normally they have been emptying the backfield in this situation. Someone has to keep an eye on McCoy with this formation. Third down. Fires in underneath and he's got the first down. Goodwin, the freshman, makes the catch across the 40-yard line and the chains move.
What a great catch here by the true freshman, known for his speed, but he has shown America this year that he's more than a track man playing football. He's a football player. This is a great catch at a crucial moment in this game. The ball is thrown low and behind him. Does a good job of adjusting and making that catch, and they really now are starting to attack Denard 15, the corner to the near side.
Roll to the right, throw underneath to Buckner. Pick up a couple of yards on that play. Ama Kamara knocks him out of bounds on that far side in front of the Nebraska bench. Inside of 6 minutes now, 1-point game, Texas leading 10-9.
Mac Brown has to be pleased to see his offense being the aggressor. They're dictating the tempo instead of the other way, which is the way it's been most of this game. Now they're trying to attack Nebraska to get them back on their heels and continue to move this ball.
Second and 8. Screen to Shipley. Won't get there. It'll be third down coming up for Texas.
DeJuan Combs has played about as well as you can play. Versatile athlete. Comes in as a sixth defensive back. He's been blitzing. He's been in coverage. He's been in run support. Does a good job of pushing the play back into the inside where Cameron Meredith eventually makes the play.
Third down again for McCoy and the Longhorns. Fire short of the first down and taken away by Gomes. Gomes has got it, intercepted. What a play by Gomes. It looked like Buckner had the catch and Gomes took it away.
Unbelievable effort here by Gomes. We just talked about his versatility and how important he and Eric Hag have been tonight to this Nebraska defense. Brent, it looked like Buckner made the catch, but at the last moment as he's going down, look at him strip the ball before Buckner touches the turf. Gomes rips the ball away from him in a tenacious effort and attitude to get that football back to Nebraska.
The junior from Hayward, California. Fine play by Zach Lee. had everybody fooled on the handoff to Burkhead, kept it himself, and he's out near midfield. The longest run from scrimmage of the night for Nebraska, and it's 17 yards, Herbie.
They didn't block Lamar Houston. He was reading Lamar Houston, and Lamar Houston was in no man's land. He committed down on Burkhead. Great read that time by Zach Lee, and he gets upfield in a hurry.
They have a kicker with a huge leg, remember. First down and 10. Burkhead again, this time slamming behind the left side. Let's go to Matt Weiner quickly in New York.
All right, Brett, on ESPN right now, Clemson's C.J. Spiller could be running his way all the way to New York next weekend. Spiller, big chunk of yardage again here, 54 yards. He has 234 and four touchdowns. This set up the go-ahead score. The Tigers lead the ACC championship by one.
Great performance by Spiller in that game. Here a second down and 5. An option look. Lee is going to pitch. Burkhead will be short of the first down. Houston.
It's very, very tough to try to get the football to the outside. Zach Lee needs to attack a little bit better on Acho. He's able to get around Acho, but Aaron Williams as a cornerback showing you he's willing to be physical coming up along with Lamar Houston, the big defensive tackle. That play did not have a chance to the outside there.
Texas and Nebraska fans, both sides up. Third and 4 at the 3:22 mark. Zach got one on one, got the first down. And then some to the 30-yard line. Brandon Kinney, the 6'3 sophomore from Kansas City, Missouri. A 16-yard gain, and they are moving into field goal range.
Kinney, second time this half, showing it a great opportunity on third down to make a catch. He's going up against Curtis Brown. He makes the catch about a yard short of the first down, but look at the effort after he makes the catch, not only fighting through Brown, but the Texas Longhorns leading tackler, Roderick McElroy, also slipped through his hands as well.
We are 30 yards away from BCS chaos. And here is Lee's handoff, Burkhead, behind the left side. They have finally found a little running room. Robinson makes the stop, but Keith Williams and Mike Smith. Smith is a junior from Vegas. Williams is a junior out of Missouri, and they are opening just a little bit of a crease for a couple of yards. The field goal kicker, Alex Henry, has a 57 career long at 46 long this season. Second down now. Clock coming down toward the 2-minute mark. Here's Burkhead into the middle. Here comes another of those third downs.
All right, Brent. Third down here, under 2 minutes. Looks like we're going to get a timeout here by Texas. Mac Brown jumping down the field. They're going to be down to two timeouts now. But you think about Nebraska and what they want to do here, and we'll talk more when we come back about strategy, what a decision Bo Pelini has.
Well, MetLife is providing today's aerial coverage. Visit MetLife.com to learn more about MetLife's long history of providing coverage at major sporting events.
Got to get the football to the middle of the field. Brent, you talked about Henry and how he's capable of making these kicks. Run it off to the right, get it in the middle of the field, and kick about a 42-yard field goal.
That's exactly what they're doing, Herbie. Just exactly what you said they would do. Get it to the 25. Now, Alex Henry has kicked 7 of his last 8 field goal attempts successfully, all right? He has hit 3 here tonight, and the second Nebraska field goal was the Big 12 championship record. That was 52 yards. And he has, against Colorado, I believe it was, last year, he has kicked a 57. Now, that's what he's done here tonight. So they're bringing him on out. Number 90, junior from Omaha, Nebraska. This is an amazing performance that without the offense really chipping in until late, the defense gave Nebraska a chance to upset a heavily favored Texas Longhorn team.
Yeah, Colt McCoy needs to get his dauber up here, because even if they make this field goal, Colt McCoy is going to have plenty of time with the timeout to get down into field goal range himself.
43-yarder.
on its way. He's got it. Nebraska takes the lead. We are a minute 44 away from BCS chaos.
There was no doubt. I mean, Henry has the confidence. You talked about the streak he was on coming into this game. He's hit some big kicks, and it's textbook tonight for Nebraska. Great defense, special teams, taking advantage of some turnovers. They knew if they could hang around for four quarters that they could find a way to win it in the fourth quarter, and now it comes down to their defense once again against Colt McCoy.
Cincinnati faced this in the snow earlier today in Pittsburgh, and they answered the bell and drove down the field for the winning touchdown to win the Big East. They are one of the teams on pins and needles right now. TCU would be the other if Nebraska can hang on. One of those two, in all likelihood, will go to Pasadena to play Alabama for the national championship. It's out of bounds and come to the 40-yard line. Oh, that's great field position on the penalty.
Wow, and they're working to get into field goal range themselves. What a break for Colt McCoy in Texas. Now they have to go against Sue in this defense, but outstanding field position.
Of course, after this game, we've got late local news over most of these stations on ESPN. We'll have SportsCenter post-game analysis of these games. Could this be a day in which both Tim Tebow and Colt McCoy go down to huge losses? Now, Colt McCoy's got a lot of time. He has one timeout to work with here. Very talented receivers. And here we come.
As a quarterback, these are the moments you hope for with the game, the ball in your hands or the game on the line.
The middle to Shipley, and Shipley runs free. And there's a penalty flag, another one. Flags fly, and Shipley broke to the 42-yard line.
We're going to get a horse collar tackle that time. Larry Asante trying to chase down Jordan Shipley from behind.
Personal foul, horse collar tackle, defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
So instead of a 19-yard completion, it is a 34-yard gain.
It's right at the end of the play. Asante comes in trying to catch up. Easy call for the officials, and another second big break for Texas on this such an important drive here for Colt McCoy.
Now Hunter Lawrence, he has been red hot as a kicker of late too. Texas is down a pair back. McCoy will take off, and it'll be second down coming up.
This is where Mack Brown feels so good about this situation, because he's got Colt McCoy, who's been in these similar situations, and he knows what to do. He knows how to work the clock. He knows subconsciously where you have one timeout. You know where you need to get. You know who you need to get your field goal kicker lined up to have confidence to kick the game-winning field goal.
Texas wants to hurry up here. They don't want to have to burn this last timeout, because the play clock is coming down inside of 10. They've got to hurry it up a little bit. Plenty of time now. He settles in at 5. Quarterback draw, and he bounces back out to the left side, and Gomes wrestles him down for a yard loss.
They need some more yards, I think, to feel like this is a no-brainer. The clock's ticking. Texas's offense trying to get organized here. Got one more play here before the field goal attempt. Better hurry up.
Third down and 13. Roll pocket right. Throw it out of bounds and stop the clock. Wait a minute. Did the game end? Nebraska thinks it's over. McCoy may have run the clock out. Mack thinks there's a second left. I thought there was a second left. I think Bo Pelini should settle down the Nebraska sideline. I think they can look at the clock in this situation. I thought there was a second.
The previous play is underscored and reviewed.
They will look at the clock. Let's check it out. Here's the replay that they will be watching upstairs. There's the game clock is what is important.
And the ball lands with 1 second.
1 second left.
1 second left.
1 second left on that clock right there. I thought I was back in the Alamo Bowl a few years ago with Michigan and Nebraska with guys running all over the field out there. And now Bo, he's got to get over Buddy over there. Now remember, Ndamukong Suh has blocked 3 kicks this year.
After further review, there's 1 second left on the game clock. Fourth down.
So here we go. Hunter Lawrence. The line of scrimmage, I believe, was up around the 29, wasn't it, on the incompleted pass? So it'll be up at around the 29-yard line. What is that, about a 46-yard field goal? That's no gimme.
No, not at all.
That is no gimme here. Now, this coming down to the last play of the night. A BCS championship appearance on the line for Texas. Cincinnati and TCU, the reason why we're not saying who's going to be the winner in that, it'll go to the vote. There will be the human voters, the coaches, there'll be the Harris poll, and it'll be the computers that will have to sort that out if Hunter Lawrence does not make this field goal. So here it comes, ladies and gentlemen. Your 46-yarder.
Pelini just called a timeout, trying to freeze Lawrence.
He's got to calm himself down.
Calm himself down, yeah. Brent, I was really surprised at how casual Colt McCoy, as a veteran quarterback, really was there with that timeout.
I'm going to suggest that he was looking at the play clock and not the game clock.
I don't know.
He had a lot more time on the play clock right. He didn't realize the game clock was coming, but I certainly agree with you.
I mean, you would expect Colt McCoy, maybe he's a little woozy, but see, there's the game clock.
See, there's the play clock. Now, his vision.
He's taking his time, but he should know that he's under 10 seconds left. But look how casual he is as he just kind of rolls to his right and then eventually gets rid of the ball. But nonetheless, they still have the 1 second.
The 46-yarder. For everything. Got it. Texas goes to Pasadena.
Said the whole time. This was a great win for Texas.
All right, thank you very much, Matt. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Braden Shipley is the holder. Greg Smith snaps it back. And Hunter Lawrence will do the rest. Just slipped it in.
Brent, as a baseball player, you want the bat in your hands in the bottom of the ninth inning. A basketball player, you want to have the ball in your hands. And as a kicker, you want to have a chance to win this game. And Hunter Lawrence shows you that he's got the nerves to be able to handle it. And Colt McCoy and the rest of the Longhorns can only imagine the jubilation, what they're feeling as they're able to escape Bo Pelini in Nebraska. Oh, my gosh. What a game.
An amazing comeback. And remember, it went down to instant replay. Instant replay put the second back on the clock, which was legitimate. As the ball went out of bounds, you saw the clock count down. Talk about a heartbreaking loss. And I've got to say that Ndamukong Suh, number 93 of Nebraska, played as fine of defensive football game as I have ever seen.
I'm with you. I'm with you. That was a dominating performance. And you mentioned the 1 second, Brent. It was the right call once they went upstairs and reviewed it.
Back to Lisa.
Thanks, guys. Colt, tell me, what were you thinking when that ball left Hunter Lawrence's foot?
I love Hunter to death. He's clutch. He works for those situations, and he always tells me, get inside the 30 and he'll make it do. So, you know, I thank God. Tonight, Nebraska's defense played outstanding. Our defense played outstanding. You got to give them all the credit in the world. We had so many things not go our way tonight, but we were able to find a way.
Colt, what happened that last play from scrimmage that you had when you threw the ball out of bounds? Time almost ran out. What happened with management there?
Well, there was 15 seconds left. The line got a little bit confused, so I rolled out and threw out of bounds. You know, expecting there to be 1 or 2 seconds left on the clock. They rushed the field early. I knew there was time on the clock left.
So did you know that you had a second or two left, or you were just holding?
No, I did. I saw the clock before the snap. You know, I knew if there was a lane, I was going to get on the right side, call timeout for Hunter. So he likes it on the right side, but, you know, it works.
All right. And why did you struggle so much tonight?
Nebraska's defense is great. They're one of the best I've played. You know, they did their job tonight. We were able to find a way in the end.
All right. Thank you very much. Congratulations. Guys.
Well, a reminder for everybody that still ahead of us, that will be the Ford wrap-up and a defensive struggle to the bitter end here in Texas as we take a look at the Pacific Life game summary, Herbie.
The game was dominated by both the defenses. You can see at the end of the day, neither team had a great night. It was a battle of wills. The two defenses played so well, but at the end, Hunter Lawrence made the play to win it.
There's Hunter with Lisa.
Thanks, guys. Hunter, you know, what was going through your mind?
You know, the defense playing great. Colton and them just got a drive at the very end there, got me in position. I knew I had to make it, you know, because they've been working their butt off this whole game. You know, that defense is awesome, and I'm just glad I can make it for the team.
They called a timeout, tried to ice you. You had some extra time to think. What do you think about in a situation like that, knowing that your national championship hopes are on the line?
I tried not to think about it, you know, during the kick, but just kind of cleared my mind. I figured they were going to ice me. When it happened, I just kind of walked back, took my steps, you know, took it all over. Jordan came over and talked to me, just calmed me down.
So, what did they say? What did your teammates say to you?
Jordan actually told me Bible verse, you know, kind of calmed me down. He's really good like that. He's always cool under pressure, as you can tell, earlier in the drive. So it's amazing.
When did you know it was good?
It took me a while to realize it. You know? At the very beginning, you know, it went up, and I didn't realize what was going on until it went through, and I got tackled, and so I realized it. So.
Congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
Brent.
Lisa, thank you very much. The kicker from a big athletic background. Both mom and dad were athletes. Father was at SMU. And so he was so cool under pressure. That was the one thing that struck me. And Herbie, let's wrap this up. Let's put a button on this. What are your feelings about today?
Just when it looked like we might have a chance for chaos, and we talked about the possibility of Nebraska hanging around, and they did everything that they needed to win this football game. But at the end, Texas made enough plays in that last drive to be able to win it. Remember, they caught a break. The kickoff went out of bounds. There was a personal foul, 15 yards, that got them downfield. Without those two plays, I don't know if they have a chance to get down there and kick that field goal. So, great effort by Nebraska. Texas gets their opportunity to finish undefeated, a Big 12 championship. Now we get Alabama and Texas in a national title. Game on.
Yeah, exactly. And
And so it was another Big 12 championship classic. Texas wins it on a final second field goal. Colt McCoy struggled all night long, but he let him down to the winning field goal. And now we're going to take you to Times Square for the Ford wrap-up. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer, take it away from Cowboy Stadium, where another classic has unfolded.
Now, what are you going to do?
Come on in, guys. Come ahead and come have a seat, would you?
Our student athlete's going to join us. We got a question for Coach on the left.
Kevin Suits, Channel 10, 11 in Lincoln. Coach, how do you address your team following this loss?
I told them I'm proud of them. They're champions. I'm proud of how they put Nebraska back on the map. They just kept fighting. That's what this group has done all year long. You know, nobody gave us a chance going into that football game tonight. And I'm proud of these guys. I'm proud of these guys to my left. They fought. They fought hard. It didn't happen. You know, it's part of the game. You know, and you give it your best shot and let the chips fall where they may. But regardless of what the score is up there, I told the guys last night, for the way they've fought through things this year, and they're champions no matter what the scoreboard says at the end. I'm proud of them.
Got a question on the platform in the rear.
Coach Pelini, Ross Jernstrom, Channel 6. Talk about the play down at the goal line in the fourth quarter. Texas is on the one-foot line, and they throw the pass to Shipley. What was the defense? What were you thinking there?
Well, I could tell you what the defense is, but you guys wouldn't know what they call me. So they made a play. You know, Shipley's a heck of a player. The quarterback made a play. You know, we should have had it covered. We didn't. They made a play, but we eventually rose up. That was the drive, I believe, that Combs made the interception. And they're a good offense. They're going to make some plays. They have a lot of talent over there, and you're not going to shut them down all the time. That was a big play in the game, but ultimately we were able to get enough points to take the lead. We just weren't able to hold it. So once again, I give Texas credit.
We've got a question all the way on the left on the platform.
J.J. Davis, Fox, Omaha. Bo, you've been in a lot of games. Have you ever been in a game that ended in this manner and felt like you did?
I've been in a lot of football games. I've been coaching for a long time, and I've had great wins. I've had some tough losses. It's not about me. It's about these young men. I hurt for them. I hurt because of the effort they gave, and it's not about me. It's never been about me. It never will be about me or the staff. It's about the kids, and they're hurting right now. But, you know, it's part of life. You know, you grow, you become a better person through things like this happening to you. And ultimately, it's about the effort that you give. Every single guy in that locker room all you ask in life is to be able to, when you're done with the football game, you can walk out of that locker room and hold your head high. And I promise you, there isn't a guy on our football team that can't hold his head high and be proud of that effort we gave tonight.
Do we have any questions for our student athletes? We got a question on the right side front.
This is for Matt. Matt, would you just talk about the defensive effort tonight and what you hope to do going in and talk about the effort in general?
We just wanted to limit their playmaking ability. I think we did a pretty good job of that. We could have had some key stops maybe at the beginning of the game, but didn't go our way. So our game plan was just to try to hold them off and just have enough points on the board to win the game. And at the end of the game, we didn't do that.
That's a brilliant question on the left, about halfway back and up, and then we'll go to the right.
And Dominican, what did you think when you heard there's 1 second?
He's not here.
You talking to a ghost?
All right. He is coming, but he's not
okay,
here.
I'll go with Matt then. When you heard there's 1 second left on the clock, what did you think? What's going through your mind?
I can't even tell you. I mean, we thought we won the game. I guess he threw it out of bounds early enough. So they made that the play that they needed at the end of the game to win it. So give credit to them.
We got a question about halfway back on the right.
Matt, could you just talk about how
crucial Ndamukong Suh was and how disruptive he was and what you saw out of him today.
I mean, he's the staple of our defense. I mean, he makes plays where, you know, not a lot of other guys could. So.
Three and McCoy back.
For us to have him, you know, in the trenches, he plays his butt off, and like I said before, he makes a lot of plays and no one else could. So he definitely, you know, kept our defense in it.
Get it out of there. And there is a counter.
Questions for our student athletes or coach? On the left, all the way in the back, and then we got one on the right.
And Dominic, can you just talk about how everything kind of unfolded there on that final possession for Texas getting the field goal?
As far as I'm concerned, I thought the time was over, but obviously, I mean, it wasn't. So they had an opportunity to kick a field goal. And from that point on, I mean, our job on the defensive line and as a team is to block that field goal. And obviously, we didn't do that, so ended up winning the game.
Three, and McCoy back, going to throw and to take off.
So you're one of the seniors out this
team. Wait. Let's get a microphone to you. Hold on. Okay, go ahead.
Sue is one of the senior leaders on this team. You've obviously played for the Huskers for a number of games now. What's the initial emotion, though, in the way this thing worked out?
My initial emotion is very unfortunate the way things unfolded. But, I mean, I think this team played very, very hard. And that's what we can all really – that's all we can really do. And then, we, like our coach says, let the chips fall where they fall. Just go out there and play as hard as you can. And then, I mean, they're going to handle the score. They're going to do everything to put us in the right positions as they did. And, I mean, all we got to do is go out there and play.
Further questions for our student athletes? Got one on the left.
And Dominican, do you see anything differently today? And what do you think enabled you to be so disruptive at the line of scrimmage?
I mean, that's really due to Coach JP and Coach Carl. I mean, the way they break down, and like I said before, the way they break down offenses and the way they teach us is just exactly how they would do it for the DBs. We understand formations and everything and know what to expect. So that allows us to have that edge to when we see this formation or see certain things, have these keys, we can go about our business and be disruptive. That's our job to do. And as long as we are coached the way we're played, obviously good things are going to happen.
Question on the halfway back here. On the left.
Alex, what was it like for you thinking you'd kicked the game winner and then having to watch another kick go up?
I knew there was still time. After I hit that, I knew there was still time left. So I don't know, just kind of made sure you guys knew that we had to make a stop there. But it felt, I don't know, I hit it well, so I was excited.
Got a question on the left about a quarter of the way back.
Niles, after you guys had gone on the field and you were celebrating and you were told to go back to the sideline, amongst the teammates, what was said to each other, you know, as they put the ball down for another play?
A lot of us was upset, but the referees felt like it was a second left on the clock. Then, I mean, that was their decision. That's pretty much all I can say about that.
Got a question on the platform in the middle.
This is for Niles. You had a kickoff return and a punt return for long yards. Just talk about what worked for you on that special teams returns.
I was just out there trying to make a play for my team. You know, I seen things. People were blocking real hard, and everybody was. I just followed my instincts, and I mean, things went well.
Yeah. We're going to take one more question for our student athletes, and we're going to let them go back to the locker room. If you have any more questions for the student athletes, gentlemen, congratulations on a great season and a great game tonight. We got any more questions for Coach? Okay, Coach, thank you very much.
Here we go, Mike A.
I'm the best man to interview.
All right, well, it's been an interesting night here, to say the least, at Cowboys Stadium. And I will tell you, Bo Pelini was much more composed when he got to the podium than when he came off the field after Texas got that extra second to kick the game-winning field goal. We'll roll the video of this field goal, but Bo Pelini was screaming down the hallway at some Big 12 officials that he wanted to see Walt Anderson, the supervisor of Big 12 officials, immediately. Carl Pelini was saying that Texas should be embarrassed to accept the Big 12 Conference trophy. I will tell you that fans are a little more adamant than the coaches were. Some people are, you know, it does make you wonder. And I'm not suggesting that there's any element of, let's just say this. Teams that are winning sometimes tend to get the breaks. And it just, you know, there were a lot of penalties called down the stretch. There was an extra second put on the clock at the end. You know, I'm not going to suggest that anything was conjured up, but it was an interesting situation. And I will say, it does make a fan wonder. And I know that the players were upset that throwing helmets in the locker room. And it was a very interesting situation after the game. And what's that now? Let's go back to the post-game news conference. Okay. Okay. All right. We're kind of flying by the seat of our pants here, but and I'm not sure what we just saw there. So, Bo Pelini was yelling at an official. Okay. All right. He was yelling at somebody in the post game. We're actually outside, so we don't really know what's going on there. Let's roll some tape here of Ndamukong Suh. Let's talk about something positive. This guy had an incredible game tonight. He set the Big 12 Conference Championship game record for sacks in a game. And last I had him, he was at 4.5 sacks. The guy played incredible. I will say this. I think your Heisman Trophy winner was wearing scarlet and cream tonight, or should be Heisman Trophy winner. But Ndamukong Suh will get my number one vote for the Heisman Trophy. I will just say that. Colt McCoy, maybe two or three. But if that guy is not the best college football player this season, well, I don't know who is. He's going to be the number one draft pick more than likely in the NFL. And we're going to have a lot more for you coming from Dallas. But let's throw it back to Omaha right now, and we'll wait here as Mac Brown gets ready to go to the podium here.
End of ball games, and these guys know how to win. They've got tremendous character. They never give up. They are as good at one-minute offense at the end of the game as anybody in the country. And we were disappointed offensively that Nebraska handled us a lot of the game, but we handled them. So it was a defensive football game. They made a couple of plays in the kicking game. We were lucky when they kicked the ball out of the bounds at the end on the kickoff, and our guys took it the length of the field, and Hunter hadn't missed a kick all year. He had one blocked, and he had a 50-something yarder hit the goalpost, so we knew we'd have a chance to make it. So really proud of the guys and excited about playing Alabama for the national championship.
Okay, we're ready for questions. If you will, please make sure we get a microphone to you. We've got a question on the aisle. And if you would, give your name and your affiliation, please.
Suzanne Halliburton, Austin American Statesman. Is it okay if I ask the players a question?
Absolutely, absolutely.
I'd rather you.
Okay, Hunter, this is the first time you've won a game with a kick at the last second. I mean, how did you stay calm with everybody else just going berserk around you?
Jordan helped out a lot. He always talks to me out there whenever I'm out there and kind of calms me down. And everybody on the team was really confident. You know, we went out there, and I knew I had to make it because their defense been playing so well, and our offense did amazing in the last minute to get us in the shot, you know, give us a chance. And I just had to make it for them.
Questions for our student athletes. We're going to try to get them out of here quickly. Chip, we'll take you in the center right over here on the aisle, and then we'll go to the outside.
Jordan, I guess, can you talk about what you said to Hunter right before that? Because obviously you don't get a scene like that very often where the other team's out on the field thinking they've won the game and all the craziness that was going on out there. What was going through y'all's minds in addition with that?
Well, mostly I gave him a Bible verse. We've kind of been doing that, you know, before practice every time we warm up, and I think that's it's just kind of been something we've shared over the last couple of weeks, and so you know I gave him Jeremiah 17:7, blessed is a man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in Him, and you know I think we all had faith in Hunter and his ability, and you know I think. Everybody on our sideline was, you know, was full of faith and confidence, and you know that he was going to make that kick.
We've got a question on the aisle right, and then we'll go over to the front.
Mac, Kevin Robbins, Austin American Statesman. How would you characterize the way Colt played tonight?
I think Colt played great. We didn't help him at times. We didn't give him enough protection, and he was tough, and he never got frustrated with a tremendous amount of pressure on him, and led us to the drive to win a game. We drop a touchdown pass. We did not help him. Offensively, we'll be excited to get back in the film room. And it's really funny, when you play as good as we did offensively last week and struggled as much as we did defensively, the defense came in here excited about proving last week was an aberration, and the offense probably felt like they were going to run up and down the field. Nebraska's a great defense and probably took some things for granted tonight. So that's why you win as a team. Last week we needed the offense to win. This week the defense hung in there, and the kicking game ended up helping us win.
Second row left.
Mac and Earl or Jordan, what was going through your minds when the play clock ran out and went down to zero and they had to put a second back on?
I'll speak first. I knew there was a second left. I was trying to get time out with the official, and he couldn't hear me, and it was loud. And then Colt snapped the ball, and Colt knows what he's doing. So he said, Coach, I threw it away. I looked at the end zone. We were trying to get 5 yards and get out of bounds, but I saw the clock was down enough. I threw it out of bounds, and he thought there were 2 seconds left instead of one. So I never even felt that there was any chance that there wasn't some time left on the clock. He's been around too long to do that.
Question on the front right, and then we'll go over here on the left. Right here.
Mac, I wonder, Tim Griffin from ESPN.com, I wonder if you could talk about those last two drives in the fourth quarter, maybe if they'll be Colt's legacy as far as playing at Texas, the way he was able to come back and play.
I think so. Everybody wants a Heisman moment, and I thought that was it. He's 45 wins. He did the same thing against Tech last year when he brought us down to win, and then they scored with seconds left. But I think that's his 12th fourth quarter comeback. And honestly, what Jordan said is so true about our entire sideline. When we saw there was a minute 49 left, we were glad that they had to kick the field goal, because that's plenty of time for our offense to score. And it's just so many times before the half or at the end of the game, we've driven down and scored to win a ball game.
Right-hand side.
Sean Adams, ESPN Austin. This is for Sergio and Earl. Coming into this game, you were kind of maligned a little bit last week. There was a turnaround. You guys played great this week, and you guys had to hold it down until the offense could get it together so you could win the game. Talk a little bit about the mindset on the sidelines as you had to keep going out there and making stops.
Well, we knew once Colt gets rolling, he's hard to stop. And we only can do what we can control. And that's what Coach kept telling us. And I think we did a pretty good job of just holding the field goals and just fighting it. And it was a physical game on both sides of the ball. And I'm just glad we got the win.
You know, just going back, is it on? Going back from last week, you know, Muschamp, you know, looking at our game from last week, that wasn't our standard. Not taking anything from A&M, but, you know, all year we played, you know, pretty good on defense. So first of all, we had to get back in the film room, and you know, we got back to our standard, and we came out, and practice pays off, as you can see.
We got a question on the front, all the way on the aisle.
Andy Staples from SportsIllustrated.com. Jordan, when you guys were backed up on the one, and they've been killing you all night, what was the mood like in the huddle? Did Colt say anything to kind of calm everybody down?
Well, I think you know, Colt's always really good about keeping everybody calm and focused, and he doesn't get rattled by, you know, anything bad that happens. And I think that, you know, that's, you know, a big testament to why he's, you know, probably the best quarterback, you know, that's playing the game right now. And he's so poised under pressure, and he always seems to, you know, like Coach said, he's, you know, had more fourth quarter comebacks than anybody, and so I think he keeps everybody calm.
We got a question on the aisle left, and then we're going to go all the way to the back on the
This question is for Sergio. Can you talk about the huge swing of emotions that you guys have, you know, going from watching them celebrate to you guys getting that opportunity and then making the field goal?
Well, when we saw Coach throw the ball, it did look like it was some time left. I just, you know, it's never good when something is in, somebody other than your team's hands. So, you know, hopefully we was thinking that the Lord saw the clock on one and that the ref was going to stay true to his morals and give us our second. And then, you know, since we got it, you know, after that, you know, I got confidence in all our guys, you know, from Big Toe here to Big Arm and Coach. So, you know, once those guys get out there, we call the team automatic, and that's what they were today.
Got a question on the platform back in the back. Okay, well, that's fine. There you go.
Ryan Mosley, ESPN Radio here in Dallas. Coach, can you talk about the play in Ndamukong Suh, and when's the last time you saw a defensive player put on a performance like that on a stage like this?
We thought that McCoy at Oklahoma was as good as we've seen in years, and Ndamukong Suh did the same tonight. He was all over the place, and we just couldn't handle him. And I tried to find him after the game to wish him good luck in the NFL, because I don't want to see him again. He is really, really good. And played hard all night. Thought their entire defense played well, played hard.
We got a question on the...
He is a senior, isn't he? I thought he was.
Yeah. We got another question back on the platform. I can't remember who had their hand up. Somebody back there.
If he's a junior, I wasn't trying to make fun, get him out of here early, so don't get me in trouble.
Okay, well, we'll move up to the front right, but we're going to take one on the left. Somebody had their hand up over here. Right, there we go. And we'll take that. We'll move over to the right.
Mac, after coming up short last year, what does it mean to get back to the BCS National Championship?
I'm sorry.
To get back to the BCS National Championship game.
One of the young guys said in the dressing room, which was so correct, that we can quit talking about 0.128 now because it's gone. And that the guys a year and 6 days ago committed to come to this game and win and be undefeated, and they've done that. And now they're really excited about playing a great Alabama team. Okay. This bunch, the five-year seniors were at the Rose Bowl with the national championship in 2005, so it's only fitting that they're going back to try to win again.
Question on the right.
Hi, Colt. Colt, over here. Kevin Robbins, American Statesman. Just give us some thoughts on what you faced tonight on the offensive side, how it was different from the last time you played in A&M.
You got to give them credit. Those guys are really tough. They had a great game plan. They really came after us, and they matched up to our receivers really well. They put a lot of pressure on us in the backfield, and but you know what? Our team found a way to win, and that's the most important thing.
We got a question on the left on the aisle. The right on the aisle, sorry.
For Mac and Colt, Bob Ballou, CBS in Austin. Can you guys just talk a little bit? You've said all year long, 1 second better, be 1 second better, and then it came down, your season came down to being 1 second better, and just how that played out tonight.
Hunter's always wanted to be on that stage. He's been asking me all year to get there. I'm glad I'm sitting up here because I'm not getting hit. You know, it was one of those nights. Those guys played really tough defense all night long, and it came down to 1 second. Hunter, is clutch. He works on that in practice all the time, and we're a team. Our defense played great, too. And you got to give them credit. And, we knew it was going to be tough coming in. Obviously, we didn't want it to come down to the wire like that, but we were able to pull through.
We constantly talk to our guys about close games and being able to win close games, and they've been in that position a bunch. And they've won all of them since they've been here except the one at Tech. And that was a very difficult one, and I think that one probably helped them keep their patience and understand what they had to do to win tonight.